Seyfitz Arena is the site for Fordham and St. Louis women's basketball here on WFUV Sports. Glad you could join us. Jackson Heil, Nick DeLuca here with you. And Nick, quite a road trip for Fordham. Expecting to have to go to Dayton, Ohio and play the Flyers, the reigning conference champions. They arrive to a positive Dayton test. And then a six-hour bus ride to St. Louis to take on the Billikens.
Yeah, usually those two places, of course, aren't really close to each other. So when you're planning on going to Dayton and then you have to turn around and take the bus all the way to St. Louis, there's a lot of travel that goes into that. And I'm really fascinated about how Fordham is going to handle all this adversity and all the stuff that has gone on, because it's such a difficult thing to have to deal with. I mean, you go in and the travel is never fun. That's never something that everyone goes in and says, yeah, I want to play basketball in college because of the travel, right? I mean, nobody signs up for it that way. So just a lot of things that they have to deal with and a lot of things that they have to overcome. But at the end of the day, they're there playing St. Louis. And you know what? St. Louis is a pretty darn good team, so they're going to have to bring it this afternoon.
They are, and they're also a team that has faced adversity themselves. And by adversity, it's a 41-day layoff. They haven't played since December 6th. This is their conference opener, and it's got to be tough for a team to say, hey, we don't even think we're playing this weekend. But then you find out 48 hours beforehand, we haven't played a game in over a month and a week in addition to that. And now we got to play a team in Fordham that has been very competitive against St. Louis. I mean, this series has been laser tight. I mean, 10 wins for Fordham, 11 for St. Louis, and the 21 between the two. It's going to be a tough test for St. Louis as well, even though being at home, being rested, you got to expect to be some rust, especially in the first half of this one.
Yeah, it's really going to be interesting to see that too, because it's the nature of what we're all dealing with, right? 2020, 2021, and you're trying to figure out when you're going to play, and it's a 41-day layoff. And now, you know, there's an argument to be made that says St. Louis, they're chomping at the bit, and they just want to see someone that's not their own team going out there and playing. But also at the same time, we know, as we've seen with Fordham earlier this year, it's a big adjustment when you're going in and playing real games as opposed to playing in practice. So you feel like you're going to get a St. Louis team that's going to come out with some energy. Now it's about for them focusing and making the correct plays, channeling that energy that they're going to come out with and finding a way to minimize the mistakes. You know, there's going to be some rust and there's going to be some miscommunication, some things that you can't replicate in practice, but just minimizing that for them and for Fordham, just trying to take advantage of those mistakes when they come.
We are back here at Rose Hill. The Fordham Rams are out in St. Louis getting set to take on the Billikens, and got to catch up with head coach Stephanie Gately yesterday. We had a long conversation about a lot of things, including what's it like taking a 6-hour bus ride down to St. Louis to have to take them on in 48 hours notice.
All right, coach. Well, the year of 2020, 2021 continues in its chaos. I mean, you guys are traveling initially to play Dayton, and now you are in St. Louis to play the Billikens. What have these last 24 hours been like from your perspective?
You know, I had gone in to get my test Friday morning. Now, we came out Thursday night because the only flight we could get Friday wouldn't get us in until after 10. So that's why we had to go out Thursday. Otherwise, you risk not getting a flight out. So we get out here, and then I do the test. And then 2 hours later at like noon, when our kids were all testing, you know, Allie, the trainer, and Munger told me about, you know, that Dayton had tested positive. So then, of course, I get on the phone with Ed, and what we were doing, you know, I wasn't even thinking St. Louis, obviously. So Manhattan and Northeastern had reached out to me last week. So I got on my phone and tried to get a game, because originally I really don't like to play out of conference during conference season. So I reached out to Manhattan because I originally told them, hey, Northeastern's looking, you two play each other. She goes, oh, we're supposed to play each other. Maybe we can play both. So in the meantime, we were trying to arrange that game. Then I get a text from Ed, conference office, once you go to St. Louis. And then I don't want to text Manhattan right away, because I don't want to lose that game and say we're not playing in the event that we don't go to St. Louis. And then Ed said, they want you to play Saturday. I said, I'm not playing Saturday. I refuse to play Saturday. It's wrong for the team that has stayed negative to be penalized and have to get on a bus in 6 hours and expect us to play in less than 24 hours is not fair. I said, I'm not doing that. I said, so then I was hoping it would be a later in the afternoon, because we can't get a flight out to Monday. but unfortunately they put us at one. So, I mean, it just, you know, it is what it is. You know, you just got to smile in the face of adversity. Our kids, you know, the kids react to how you react, right? So I just say, hey, bring it on, man. Let's go. Take anybody on right now. So the kids are in a great space. You know, they're ready. I reminded them that St. Louis hasn't played for a while, so they're going to be extremely pumped. But we're extremely pumped, so we're ready for the challenge. We're excited.
You got to love embracing this craziness. But let's talk about St. Louis. You mentioned a team that hasn't played in nearly 41 days. You also got to prepare for a team that you weren't expecting to play this weekend. How is it going out to scout a team like that, that one, like I mentioned, really hasn't played much this year, and two, you weren't expecting to play this weekend?
I mean, it's kind of crazy. It's funny because I was talking to my son, Coop, the youngest one. He goes, Mom, like, it affects you because you're very detailed oriented, you know? But fortunately for us, they don't run a lot of things we haven't seen. So mm-hmm. we're very prepared for that. But they've had an advantage. They've gotten to see a lot of our games where we only saw them play over almost 2 months ago, you know, so the advantage goes to them. Plus they're at home. So, you know, for us, we just look at it as, you know, hey, we're going to smile in the face of adversity. I'm so proud of our kids for even being able to play games because they've done their due diligence and been extremely resilient through these very difficult times. So I just think it's going to be a typical St. Louis Fordham battle.
Coach, I'm sure you've learned a lot about your team through this process. Let's talk about the first two legs of this road trip, a win at URI, a tough loss on the road to UMass. What have you learned about them specifically through this part of this road trip?
You know what? It's interesting. After the UMass game, and I think after the kids were able to watch the tape, they realized we got out tough, you know, at the end. And you know, to their defense, it was our first road swing with that Friday-Sunday format. And so you got to bounce back pretty quick, you know, and you got to be ready to go. And Caitlin's knee had been bothering her. And, you know, so we learned a lot during that stretch. I mean, UMass is, I said all along, going to be one of the top teams. They're very well-rounded and can beat you at every position. So as evidenced by them going and beating undefeated in the conference VCU yesterday. But I like what I see, you know, like we just, you know, I thought from that game we need to be tougher, and UMass was really physical, and I think we let that affect us. One thing we also have to learn is we cannot let our offense dictate our defense. We were in a great flow in the first half, and then the second half we don't make shots, and then it goes and affects us on the defensive end. We've got to continue to understand that defense is what's going to, you know, be our foundation of what we need to be successful.
Coach, Anna DeWolf has been superb this year for you guys and has become one of the best scorers in the country. If there's one concern with her, maybe it is turnovers so far this year. She's averaging over 4 turnovers a game. How much of a concern is that for you? And how much is that a product of her just, listen, late in offense, she's trying to force something when you maybe don't have a look at the basket?
I mean, a lot of that, to be honest, comes with the fact of new territory. I mean, you know, Bryson was our go-to player last year, so Anna was kind of our secondary option. So now all of a sudden UMass throws a double, they throw a diamond and one, and, you know, and all of a sudden, you know, it's okay, how do I react? So a lot of her turnovers, we're trying to do too much. You know, we're forcing the action, and that's all going to be part of her growth. And one of the things I talked to her about after that UMass game was learning to be tougher, because when she gets frustrated, she's like, I got fouled. I'm like, you're a leader, you know, and I'll protect you. I'll make sure I defend you. But you can't come across as weak, even though, you know, she's one of our, you know, toughest kids as far as on the court. She, as soon as she shows that weak link, it kind of snowballs down. And so she's got to understand that's kind of like with me. Like if I go in and say, oh, I can't believe we got to play St. Louis, they're going to follow my lead. I'm going to go in and say, let's beat their ass. You know, like that, let's go, you know, like, so it's, you're following the leader, you know, we're playing the game, follow the leader. So, but that's all part of being a sophomore and growing and maturing in a new role.
Coach, before we wrap this up, while we're on the topic of really good guards in this conference, Kaja Harbison has been someone who has grown a lot in her first 2 years, and 25 points 41 days ago in their last game against Bradley. What's the biggest key to trying to contain her and keep her under control?
Well, I think you just said it, contain her. You know, like she's going to get her points. She takes 3 times as many shots as the next kid on her team. So, you know, if you're going to put up that number of shots, I mean, you know, she really struggled in the Memphis game, but then hit a big one and took over down the stretch. So you're not going to hold her 0 points. You just got to make sure she earns the points how you want her to earn them. You know, she does. She has a great middle game. She attacks the basket well. She's physical and aggressive defensively. So it's just really just trying for us to dictate what kind of looks that she gets, and you know, deciding what we're going to choose to give up.
Coach, we really appreciate the time, even in these crazy times for you. Best of luck this weekend and safe travels as well.
Oh, Jackson, come on. You know, you're my man. Anything for you. You better be out on that scout court next week.
You know it, Coach. You know.
Well, that's head coach Stephanie Gately, and Fordham getting set to take on St. Louis. Same starting lineups for both teams, stretching back to their last games, although be it completely different days apart. 41 for St. Louis, and we'll start with the Billikens. Kaija Harbison, Julia Martinez, Rachel Kent, Maya Clark, and Miriama Smith-Traore. And when you look at the focus there as the Billikens in their home whites with blue lettering, numbering, and trim, it's got to be Kaija Harbison. Preseason conference first team and all A-10 first team as well. For Fordham, it's Anna DeWolf, Katie McLaughlin, Kendall Haramaya, Caitlin Downey, and Megan Jonathan. Rams in their road maroons. They're going right to left. Billikens left to right, and we are underway from Scheifetz Arena, and the Billikens control the opening possession. It's Martinez right wing, sends it up top for Harbison, gets a screen left as she cuts to the foul line, pulls up, 10-foot jump shot short off the run iron, and the rebound falls into the hands of DeWolf on the near elbow. Just underway in St. Louis between Fordham and the Billikens.
Good opening possession on offense for St. Louis. They just don't get the look to go.
It's McLaughlin top of the key for the Rams. 30 seconds into this one as it's Haramaya left wing. Defended closely. The screen comes to the right from Downey as now she floats everyone off and looks to back down Clark. Gets center lane. Kicks right corner. McLaughlin all alone for three. Rattles in and out. Rebound underneath Jonathan and she kicks it out for Downey. Fresh 20 seconds for Fordham. Megan Jonathan with the offensive board. She leads the A-10 in offensive rebounds this season. It's DeWolf top of the key. Defended by Martinez. Pulls up, 18-foot jump shot. Barely grazes the front iron. And the rebound into the hands of Rachel Kent as she moves left to right.
We know Fordham's been so good on the boards, but they're going to have to find a way to get those shots to go down. Really struggled in that second half against UMass last time out.
And a quick turnover from the Billikens. Harbison trying to float it into the post to Smith-Traore. Rams will get it underneath, going the underway. Scoreless in the opening minute of this one between the Rams and the Billikens.
Yeah, I think it's just a confidence thing. They got to see a couple of those buckets go through on the offensive side, and they'll be good to go. And Coach Gately mentioned it in her open, not letting that translate to defense as well.
McLaughlin on the left wing. She'll trigger on a three, no good, and the Billikens have it the other way. Maya Clark pushing into the front court. 13 points her last time out as she finds Martinez cutting right side of the lane. Up top it goes for Kent. Rips her way to the left with 20 to shoot and hands off for Harbison. Harbison crosses over to her right, attacks through the lane, stops inside, and she's fouled by Haramaya. That is her first, team's first, and Harbison will make her first trip to the foul line.
Harbison so good at just attacking the basket and getting whatever she wants offensively. Preseason all-conference, right? She's as good as it gets offensively in this A-10, and someone that Fordham's going to have to really do a good job at trying to slow down. As you alluded to,
she sinks the first free throw. Harbison, 6 of 8 from the line against Bradley, 9 of 13 coming into this one on the year, as the second one on its way and falls through. St. Louis on the board, 2-0 on top of Fordham, 8:20 to play in this first quarter from St. Louis. It is DeWolf walking it right to left into the front court near wing. Now she bounces it for Haramaya straight on, immediately lips to her right. Now looks to back down in the lane, picks up her dribble. Towards the left hand, goes up too strong, and the rebound to Martinez, far side. Moves her way left to right, kicks it across for Harbison, right corner. Now cuts her way to the lane, out for Martinez, tries to float it inside. It's knocked away by Haramaya and into the hands of Downey. Just past 2 minutes gone, first quarter. Haramaya, right wing, pulls up on a deep three off the front iron, no good. Rebound Martinez again, near block for St. Louis.
Love to see Fordham slow it down and try and create something a little bit better than the transition three from Haramaya.
Martinez in transition, tries to get to the basket, too strong on the lay-in, and she knocks the rebound out underneath the basket. It'll go back to Fordham. 2.5 minutes gone in this first quarter. A slow start for both sides, 2-0 St. Louis.
The thing is, when you're struggling to shoot, you're trying your best to find the easy looks. Don't make it more challenging than it already is, and I'd like to see Fordham slow it down. Let's try and create some open looks. They did a great job of that on the perimeter against UMass. Get back to some of that.
It is McLaughlin dribbling to the right elbow, bounces it for Jonathan, far block. Looks to back down on Smith-Traore. Tries to go underneath, goes up with the right hand. No good, an air ball, and Smith-Traore has the rebound. Billikens the other way, left to right. Martinez in transition. Euro step in the lane. Too strong on the lay-in. Rebound, Smith-Traore. She kicks it out up top. Clark, she'll try a three. That one also too strong. And the rebound into the hands of Downey in the center of the lane. So the slow start continues for both sides. It is Downey left wing for Fordham. Rams operating right to left with 20 to shoot as she moves it for Haramaya top of the key. They continue to rotate it around the perimeter. McLaughlin, right wing. She'll try a three. Off the heel, no good, but McLaughlin chases down her own rebound, and the Rams get an extra possession. Into the post it goes Downey. Right short corner, backing in on Kent. Picks up her dribble. Double team comes. It's knocked out of her hands by Smith-Traore and picked up by Clark. Clark in transition the other way. Cuts right side of the lane. Drives to the basket. No good. But a foul is going to be called. It's going to be number two on Kendall Haramaya. And the foul trouble continues for the senior from Fiji.
And it's probably one of, if not the most crucial aspect to her entire game, is just staying out of foul trouble. Yep. And it's not necessarily even the time that she misses, but then the effect that it'll have on her rhythm offensively. It's night and day. When Kendall Haramaya can stay out of foul trouble, she's as good a player as there is in this conference. And when not, it really becomes problematic for Fordham. So they're going to have to be careful here and find a way to try and keep her out of foul trouble all further than she already is.
Clark knocks down the first. Second one on its way and good. And ironically enough, it's Haramaya staying in the game. Meg Jonathan comes out. Sarah Carpell, the sophomore from Jersey, enters the game. And she has the ball front court left for Fordham. Bounces for Downey, hands right back off for Carpell, and now finds Downey left corner. Defended by Smith-Traore, 15 to shoot for Fordham. They trail 4-0, opening 4 minutes of this one. Carpell backs things up to the logo, wants to call out a play. She gets a screen right from Haramaya. Hands off for DeWolf, curling left side with 5 to shoot. Picks up her dribble, finds a cutting Carpell, center of the lane with 2 to shoot. Spins to the right hand, goes up, gets it to go. Sarah Carpell starts the scoring for Fordham. The deficit is halved, 4-2 St. Louis.
And just as we all predicted going into this game, Sarah Carpell is going to have the first bucket for Fordham coming off the bench. But look, if it's not going to, you know, if you're not getting the greatest looks from the people you expect, you got to find scoring from somewhere. That's a good job by Carpell.
It is Clark, top of the key, defended by Haramaya. Dribbles to the right side, gets in the lane, floats it up, too short. Rebound batted to the near corner into the hands of Anna DeWolf with 5.5 to go in the first quarter. 4-2, Fordham trails. It's Haramaya, top of the key. Quick launch on a three. It's off to the right, and skying in for the board is Maya Clark for St. Louis. Left to right, she comes, bounce it right wing for Kent. She'll try her a three. That's good. Rachel Kent from downtown. She was scoreless in her last game. First time in her career she's been held without a point, but she's on the board early. And it's a 7-2 Billikens lead at the halfway point of the first quarter.
And a really great performance for her last time that these two teams met last year. So Fordham knows how dangerous she is. Surprising that she's held off the scoreboard, but right there she shows her capabilities.
DeWolf, right elbow, tries the pull-up jumper. It's in and out, and the rebound for Kent going the other way. Left to right for St. Louis. She drives to the near corner. Now stops it up for Clark. Over the top pass, Smith-Traore inside. One dribble. Gets to the right hand. Goes up. Gets it to fall. Off the glass and in over Downey. Great start for the Billikens. 9-2 lead with 4.5 to play in the first quarter.
And Fordham, for the most part, had been doing a good job in the transition defense and in that game. In the half court on that possession, not as stellar as they had been earlier this game.
Haramaya left wing looking to back down Harbison as she tries to execute the mismatch. Haramaya into the lane, kicks out right wing Downey. She'll try a three. Off to the left, too strong. And there for the rebound is Clark again for St. Louis.
That time, a good look that Fordham's just going to need to get to go down. I think there's a tendency at times when you're not shooting fantastically to try and force things. That wasn't a force. That was just, you got to find a way to get it to go.
Pass near side off the hands of McLaughlin out of bounds. And that'll bring us to a media timeout on the floor in Sheffield's Arena. 9-2 St. Louis, 4 minutes to play in this opening quarter here on WFUVsports.org. So we'll stay right here. 3:57 to play in the opening quarter and a slow shooting start for the Rams. 1 of 11 from the field. And as a result, the Billikens have been able to get things done on the other end of the floor. 9-2 they lead, and it's been a balanced attack. Kent with 3, Clark with 2, Harbison and Smith-Traore each with a bucket. And for Fordham, it's Sarah Carpell, the unlikely productor on the offensive end with the lone bucket. But again, Fordham struggling to score, and Nick, I think most importantly for the Rams right now, you're struggling to score, but also you have to manage with the fact that Kendall Jeremiah has two quick fouls.
Yeah, and I think it's going to be crucial in – this is why, you know, Coach Gately makes the big bucks in trying to make these decisions, but finding the balance between perhaps letting Jeremiah – you know, taking Jeremiah out of a potentially problematic situation with the fouls and into further foul trouble, this situation, of course, gets worse. But at the same time, it's really been a struggle offensively for them right now. And Kendall Jeremiah being off of the court won't help that. So that's really going to be the balance that Coach Gately is going to have to strike. But even if it's not Jeremiah, this team needs to find a way to generate offense. That's no secret. You're down 9-2, and you can't score 2 points in a quarter and expect to win against a team like St. Louis that, despite a 41-day layoff, is a pretty darn good team and is one that's been around and very good in this A-10 for a number of years now. So they're going to have to find a way to get the shots to go. There have been some possessions where I feel like that's a force or they're really trying to do too much on offense. Other times, good look and it's not going down. Find the balance there too on offense, but that's the story of this game. So far, you know, 6 minutes in, it's about finding a way to put the ball in the basket. It sounds simple. It's the name of the game. But Fordham really struggling offensively right now.
Yeah, there's a team we expected out to look rusty out of the gate. We figured it would be St. Louis. But credit to Lisa Stone, the head coach, ninth season with the Billikens. She has had them ready. And especially on the defensive of the floor, they're active hands. They're on the perimeter. And they're making life difficult for Fordham.
Yeah, they are, and you knew that that was going to be the case. St. Louis, Lisa Stone doing an outstanding job in her ninth season since she's been here. And again, a team that plays a little bit like Fordham, you know they want to attack defensively in sort of that being their philosophy, and they've done an excellent job thus far.
So right off the restart, it goes to Clark on the right wing. She'll fire a quick three. That one's too strong. And down he has it for Fordham. Carpell walks it up right to left the other way for the Rams, trailing 9-2 with 3:30 to play in the opening quarter. Out to Downey, right wing. She fires a three, rattles out, and the rebound to the hands of Marissa Warren, the transfer from DePaul, making her first appearance for the Billikens. Warren drives right side, kicks it up top for Clark. The Billikens reset. Kent now right wing, defended closely by Matilda Flood, the freshman recently checked into the game for Fordham. Billikens continue to operate on the perimeter. It's Clark on the left wing, pulling up from 18 feet away. It's too strong, and Flood has the rebound for the Rams.
A good defensive possession there to force a quick shot. Now Fordham trying to build on that momentum and seeing if they can transition and do it on offense.
Downey out on the left wing. Fakes a three. She's defended by Brooke Flowers. Preseason all-first defensive team, Brooke Flowers, 6'5", one of the best shot blockers in the game. As DeWolf has it left wing, tries a three, too strong, into the hands of Kent on the rebound for St. Louis.
And that one would go into the category of sort of a force, right? Anna DeWolf, that's not the best look, and Fordham comes away again empty on the offensive end.
McNeil gets it, left side drive, floats it up in the paint, an air ball, and Downey, the lone member for the Rams right there to scoop it up. 2:30 to go first quarter, 9-2 St. Louis on top of Fordham at Seifert's Arena. McLaughlin top of the key. Looks inside, finds Downey. Out it goes right wing. Flood, she's open for three. That's good. Matilda Flood, the freshman, lighting it up from behind the arc. 9-5, St. Louis leads, 2:10 to play in the first quarter.
And sometimes it's relying on the unlikely sources, right? Matilda Flood, not someone that you're going to draw up a play for, but in a big moment when Fordham's got an opportunity with an open look to get back in it, she's right there and nails the three-pointer.
Nyborg and Jeremiah back into the game for Fordham, and it's McLaughlin and Downey making their way to the bench. Harbison also back in for the Billikens, along with Julia Martinez, replacing Clark and McNeil. It'll be Billikens ball side out, 24 to shoot off the deflected pass by DeWolf, as it's Martinez backing it up to the logo. Given 3 feet of space by Jeremiah, she continues to work her way around the perimeter. Picks up her dribble, top of the key, looking for options, floats it to the elbow for Flowers. Backdoor cut, it's Harbison. Right block, she goes up and banks it in over the top of Anna DeWolf. It's Kaja Harbison with a fast start. 4 points for her and a 6-point lead for St. Louis.
Mentioned her off the top, Kaja Harbison, as good a player as there is in the A-10. And she, like I like to call Anna DeWolf, sort of a get-out-of-jail-free card. When things break down offensively, she can create her own shot and score.
It's Jeremiah top of the key. Wants a screen right from Flood. hesitates, now attacks the lane, goes up with the right hand, too strong, rebound batted out to the near wing and into the hands of Kent. Floats it ahead looking for Warren, picks it up underneath the basket, tries to get it for Flowers all alone, and she banks it up and in. Good transition offense from the Billikens, and it's Brooke Flowers banking it home to restore an 8-point lead for St. Louis.
And a point of emphasis for Coach Gately after that game against UMass, the transition defense at times had been lacking, and that time weren't able to get back.
Flood in the left corner, tries another three, too strong. Rebound loose on the floor. It's picked up by Haramaya, and the Rams get a fresh possession. 50 seconds to go in the first quarter, and 15 on the shot clock for the Rams. It's DeWolf driving to the left corner, and a foul's going to be called on the floor. That one's going to be on Harbison defending DeWolf. And that'll put the shot clock back to 20 with just over 47 seconds to go in the first quarter. 13-5, St. Louis leads Fordham.
And St. Louis has come out pretty clean, I would say, right? You're wondering how they're going to react to being off for 41 days and what's that going to look like. I think they've answered the test here, at least in this first quarter. Now you question the conditioning and the game shape going forward. What does it look like in the second half?
So it is DeWolf on the left wing, off the restart, backs up to the far side. Defended by Lauren Hughes, just into the game, bounces it inside. Nyborg goes up with the right hand, can't get it to go, and the rim bounces into the far corner. It's taken by Hughes. Now Warren walking it up will slow things down. 2-second differential between game and shot clock. As the shot clock approaches 20, game clock at 22. Warren drives left side, stops on the far wing, defended by Carpell. Now up top for Kent, immediately crosses to her left, gets to the elbow, floats up the jumper, can't get it to fall, and the rebound at the hands of Haramaya. 7 seconds to go in the first quarter. It's DeWolf at the logo with four now. Crosses over to her left. Gets inside. Bounces it out. Flood in the corner. She'll launch a three. It's blocked out of bounds by Kent as time expires. And that is how the first quarter comes to an end. 10 minutes in the books. St. Louis, 13-5 over Fordham.
One-on-One has a brand new YouTube channel. Subscribe to WFUV Sports to catch our simulcast Saturday nights and get notifications so you never miss another show. Miss the show? You can find on-demand segments, interviews, and highlights every week. WFUV Sports, home to New York's longest-running sports call-in show and the flagship station of Fordham Athletics.
Some tunes bringing us into this first quarter stoppage. 13-5 St. Louis on top of Fordham after 10 minutes of play. Jackson Heil, Nick DeLuca here with you. And if St. Louis had any rust, Nick, we didn't see it in that first quarter. I mean, defensively, they were excellent, holding Fordham to just 2 of 18 from the field, 1 of 10 from behind the arc. And offensively, they were able to move the ball in transition and got points in a lot of different ways. I mean, five different players have scored this far, and they're led by their star, Kaija Harbison, with four early points.
Yeah, I mentioned it towards the end of that first quarter, but it certainly doesn't look like they are any worse for the wear of having 41 days off and having to just practice this whole time and figure out what exactly the season was going to look like, and then it sort of brought upon you. And that's perhaps something that you can't overlook as well, that as much as St. Louis has been off, they're sort of reacting to playing this game just like Fordham is. Fordham's just had a little bit more of the opportunity to play earlier in this season. So it's a mess and a difficult situation for both teams to be in. And at the end of the day, the difference in the game is just St. Louis has made more of their offensive opportunities than Fordham. I don't think that St. Louis has had necessarily the better of the offensive play over Fordham in that sense, but it's a make or miss league. That's what we always like to say. And right now it's a make league for St. Louis and a miss league for Fordham. And the Rams trying to correct that going into the second quarter.
DeWolf, Haramaya, and Downey in that first quarter combined 0 of 9 from the field. And that's never going to get it done. I mean, listen, it's nice to get the secondary production, Carpell with an early bucket and Matilda Flood with a three as well. But for Fordham, they need their superstars to set it up. And listen, you got to give St. Louis credit. Defensively, they've been excellent, but they got to find a way to get out of the Wolf going in this one.
No, there's a reason why it's called secondary scoring, and yes. That's not their primary scoring, because they need the people that have been carrying them all year to do it again. And Anna DeWolf certainly at the top of the list when you look at her and being 18th in the NCAA in scoring, that's someone who's going to lead the way. They're going to need to get her going.
It's Fordham ball out of the timeout, moving right to left, and Carpell finds McLaughlin cutting the lane. She had a wide-open layup. Can't get it to fall. Gets her own rebound underneath and kicks it out to Haramaya. Downey drives the lane right side, gets inside. Can't get it to fall on the lane. It's too strong and grabbed by Kent for St. Louis.
And a golden opportunity for Caitlin Downey on the follow, and Rams got to be throwing their hands up in the air and saying, is there a lid on the bucket or something? Because that's just opportunities that they're not taking advantage of right now.
Harbison straight on the other end. Looks to float into the paint for Smith-Traore. Knocked out of her hands. Picked up by McLaughlin on the floor in the corner and gets into the hands of Downey. Well defended in the post. Caitlin Downey deflecting that initial pass, and Fordham has it back, trailing by 8. Opening minute of the second quarter. It's Downey left wing. She'll launch a 3. That's good. Haramaya to Downey for the triple, and this junior big is on the board. 13-8, St. Louis on top, just past the opening minute of the second quarter.
And when you've only got 8 points, every bucket you make is a big shot. That's a big shot for Caitlin Downey to come back after the miss on the last possession.
He was too strong on the right wing 3 attempt, and it's knocked out of bounds underneath by Haramaya, so we'll stay with the Billikens. And he was immediately to the bench, replaced by Maya Clark, who was shot happy in that opening quarter. 0-4 from the field for Clark, though. She does have 2 points from the foul line. It's Martinez triggering underneath, floats it up top for Kent, and work to the right wing for Harbison. Now to the corner for Clark. They're trying to feed the post to Smith-Traore, who catches 10 feet away from the basket. Spins to the left hand, goes up, gets the friendly roll off the back iron front rim and in. Miriama Smith-Traore extends the St. Louis lead to 7, opening 90 seconds of the second quarter.
And a good finish, gets the roll over Downey. Good defense, just sometimes good offense beating that good defense.
It's to McLaughlin on the right wing for Fordham. Finds Downey, short corner, skip pass, left corner. DeWolf a 3, all nylon. Anna DeWolf with her first bucket of the game. Back-to-back threes for Fordham, and they cut the deficit to 4.
And that's the movement that I was looking for in that first quarter. You're trying to figure out how can we free some people up on the perimeter. Fordham has done that. A great job the last couple of possessions to nail back-to-back threes.
And a foul call at the top of the key. Stephanie Gately doesn't like the call on Katie McLaughlin. That'll be number 1 on her. 8 minutes to play in this first half. 15-11 St. Louis on top of Fordham. Martinez, right wing extended, will trigger on the inbound. Floats it in for Smith-Traore. Center of the lane, kicks it up top. Kent, quick trigger on a 3. She's got it. Rachel Kent with her second triple. 18-11, St. Louis on top. 7:50 to play in the first half.
Fordham just loses Kent up top. She's got the room for 3. Not someone you want to leave out there alone. We know that she can certainly hit from there.
She was a top 3-point shooter in the conference last year. As Downey backs into the paint, sizes up Smith-Traore, goes up with the right hand, too strong. And Kent has another rebound for St. Louis. Kent now in transition. Left side of the lane drive. Goes up and gets it to fall. High scooping left-handed shot through the cup. And St. Louis has their largest lead. 20-11 with 7:15 to go in the first half.
Rachel Kent, problematic for Fordham on that offensive side. We know that she can shoot it from outside. Also put the ball on the floor. She shows both back-to-back possessions.
Wolf driving, gets in the lane. Tries to go to the right hand. And an offensive foul is going to be called. On the hook from Anna DeWolf as she tries to cut inside. And we'll go back to St. Louis with just over 7 minutes to play in the second quarter. Meg Johnson back in the game for Caitlin Downey.
And that one a close call. Fordham doesn't get the break there. St. Louis, suppose lucky. I mean, they're in good position. That one's so tough, but it goes against Anna DeWolf on that one.
It's Martinez up top for Harbison. She'll fire a 3. Off the heel, no good. Rebound batted out to the paint. And it's taken by McLaughlin. For Fordham. Rams right to left across timeline in their road maroon tops, looking to cut into this 9-point deficit that they face against St. Louis. Haramaya, right elbow. She pulls up on the jumper, rattles in and out. Rebound loose and picked up by Martinez at the foul line. She looks to push in transition. Left to right, she comes. Picks up her dribble, right block. Gets to Smith-Traore through the lane, and she scores. Quick timeout for Fordham. And the largest lead of the game for St. Louis, 22-11. With 6.5 minutes to go in the first half. Billiken's getting a ton of points in transition. And head coach Stephen Gately wanting to talk things over. Quick timeout on the floor. 11-point lead for the Billikens from Seifert's Arena.
WFUVsports.org is where you can go to get caught up on all things Fordham and professional sports. Take a listen to all our podcasts, including NFL Friday, 5-on-3, Picket Pod, College Gridiron, and our baseball podcast, The Nosebleeds. It's all from your online home for Fordham and professional sports, WFUVsports.org.
That is Nick DeLuca, Jackson Heil, here with you on a slow start for the Rams, especially shooting-wise. 4 of 24 from the field. 3 of their 4 field goals have been made threes. But again, Nick, the Rams come out shooting really poorly. And you got to credit St. Louis. They're forcing Fordham into a lot of tough shots. And you've talked about forcing shots. It feels like that is more of a product of what St. Louis is doing defensively, especially just hounding the Rams on the perimeter. And when you have a first-team all-conference player in Kaija Harbison, who can also defend the way she has, she's made life really difficult on Anna DeWolf. And as we know, as Fordham goes, Anna DeWolf goes.
That's the difficulty, right? When Anna DeWolf is drawing a bunch of attention, and in particular from Harbison, a defender who is at – has the ability to slow her down. You're never going to shut down Anna DeWolf, but when you don't require that double and triple team, when you have a defender who can deal with Anna DeWolf at least adequately, then it puts a lot of pressure on the rest of the pieces on your offense, because it's not as many open looks for a Caitlin Downey or for Kendall Haramaya. So it can sort of create issues for Fordham on offense. But at the end of the day, they need to work and moving the basketball a little bit and trying to create some more on that perimeter, I would say, just in general. And then if that can open things up to trying to drive towards the basket and opening things up there as well. But it's just been a struggle in the last couple of games for Fordham offensively. We've seen them go through stretches like this even into last year as well. 4 of 24 from the field is just not going to cut it if you want to beat a team like St. Louis.
And defensively, St. Louis has come out and shot the ball pretty well to go with it. They are 66% in the quarter, 4 of 6 from the field. They have a made 3 from Rachel Kent as well, who leads them with 8 points. But to me, it's what they've been able to do inside that has opened things up. And the focus there is Miriama Smith-Traore, 6 early points for her.
For sure. And I don't think the defense from Caitlin Downey down there has been bad. But this sort of goes into the overall understanding of the game. When you're 4 of 24 from the field, it puts so much stress on your defense to be perfect. And the defense for Fordham, I think, has been good, but it hasn't been perfect. And when you only score 11 points with 6 minutes left in the second quarter, you're in trouble, because you have to really clamp things down defensively.
Rams come right to left out of the timeout, and they open with possession. It is Carpell on the left wing. With under 20 to shoot, up top, McLaughlin fakes the 3. Now DeWolf, right wing, wide open for a triple. It's too strong. Rebound loose underneath, off the hands of McLaughlin, out of bounds. And they initially said it would stay with Fordham, but the officials have changed the call. Bob Enterline, the head official today, as he's the one who decides on that one. 6 minutes to play, second quarter, 11-point lead for St. Louis.
And that shot doesn't go down, but that's exactly what Fordham needs offensively. It's DeWolf coming off the screen. She's got the room wide open look. Anna DeWolf is going to hit that shot more often than not. That's a good job out of the timeout. Now more of that and get the shot to go down.
A back cut. Martinez gets in the lane and a foul is called on Meg Jonathan. Martinez couldn't get the shot to go, but she will get an opportunity to add to this lead at the free throw line. And head coach Stephanie Gately beside herself on that call. Nonetheless, 2 shots coming from the charity stripe.
And she has an argument. There wasn't a ton of contact, and if there was, it was certainly initiated by Martinez there.
And she sinks the first, but you're absolutely right. It looked like Meg Jonathan went straight up as well.
So it's tough, you know. But again, the point is, when you're struggling so much offensively, that call matters more. It puts so much stress on you to get stops and limit the production on the other side. To me, it all comes back to the offense.
Martinez can't convert on the second. So a 1 of 2 trip is Haramaya inside. Righty reverse layup is good. Great find by McLaughlin, and the lead for St. Louis cut back to 10. Carindale Haramaya on the board for Fordham.
Someone Fordham needs to get going. That's a big bucket and an encouraging sign.
It's Hughes floating it for Smith-Traore, center of the lane. Out for Harbison, right corner. A 17-footer off to the left, and the rebound snagged inside by Anna DeWolf. Fordham the other way as we approach the halfway mark of the second quarter. 23-13 St. Louis on top. As it's McLaughlin top of the key. Out to the near wing for DeWolf. She drives right side, gets in the lane, floats it up, gets the friendly roll off the right side of the iron and through. And the deficit cut to 8. St. Louis quickly the other way. It's Kent in transition for the righty lay-in. And a quick 10 points for Rachel Kent and the lead back to 10 for St. Louis.
And Anna DeWolf doing a good job on the offensive side, creating her own shot. But again, what Coach Gately talked about after that UMass game, transition defense, again, an easy bucket for St. Louis.
DeWolf at the foul line, pulls up on a jumper. It's an air ball short. And Martinez tried to save it, but they're going to say she knocked it out of bounds and her foot hit the line. So Fordham catches a break on that occasion. They'll have a fresh 20 seconds to shoot as Caitlin Downey replaces Meg Johnson. Shot clock reset back to 13. As it goes out for DeWolf, knocked away by Harbison. And left to right, she comes for St. Louis. Harbison right side of the lane. Eurostep gets inside and gets it to fall. Kaija Harbison wheeling her way through traffic. 27-15, under 4.5 to play in the opening half.
And the defensive activity for Kaija Harbison making things difficult for Fordham. And then in transition, able to knock down the bucket. Again, when the offense is struggling, another place that you got to watch are the turnovers, somewhere where Fordham has not been fantastic this year. But you really have to be perfect. This is the problem. You're forcing yourselves to really play clean basketball. If Fordham doesn't, they're going to be in trouble.
So Harbison will get a quick rest. It's Natalie McNeil back into the game. Mr. Wolf has it on the right wing. Bounces it inside for Downey. Into the left corner, McLaughlin. She'll line up a three. Too strong. Rebound grabbed by Downey. Up pop for DeWolf. Wide open for three. And this time she cashes in. Anna DeWolf with her second triple. Lead back to single digits, 27-18 St. Louis.
And DeWolf hits the shot, but an outstanding play by Caitlin Downey to snatch the rebound right out to DeWolf wide open, and that makes the play.
The right wing Martinez for St. Louis. 15 to shoot as she drives into the corner. Spins inside, goes up. No good. And a foul? No, a travel is going to be called on Julia Martinez. Head coach Stephanie Gately had her hands on her head, but this time it goes the way of Fordham.
Yeah, she thought it was a foul just for a second there, and you could see her going, wait a second here. No chance. But no, that was just too many steps there before you get to the contact.
With the way things are going, it was easy to expect it to go that way.
It's legitimate. I'll give you that.
It's Downey, finds a back cutting Haramaya, stops on the right block and scores over the top of Clark. Kendall Haramaya with her second bucket, 27-20 with 3.5 to go on the first half.
And Fordham starting to get things going offensively. The ball movement much better, the perimeter stuff opening things underneath.
And a stolen pass by DeWolf, right to left. She comes in transition, cuts right side of the lane, gets inside, goes up and banks it home. Anna DeWolf with the bucket, timeout Lisa Stone, and Fordham's right back in at 27-22 with 3:10 to go in the second quarter. And the Rams coming alive behind Anna DeWolf. She's got 10 points, and it's a big-time run for Fordham to get back into this one. They trailed by 12. A 7-0 run has cut this deficit to 5.
Be sure to stay tuned for the one-on-one halftime report when Jackson and I will take a look back at the first half and preview the second. That's coming up at halftime right here on WFUVsports.org.
That's Nick DeLuca, Jackson Heil here with you. And, Nick, we talked about Fordham stars stepping up, and with their step-ups have come a chance to get back into this game, and it's led by Anna DeWolf, the conference-leading scorer. 10 points, 4 of 9 from the field. She's gotten it going from behind the three-point line as well.
Yeah, and you mentioned it when you asked me about her in the last timeout, sort of saying as Anna DeWolf goes, Fordham goes. Well, Anna DeWolf has picked it up, and so has Fordham. Really encouraging to see her get those looks, and that's the key. You got to make things easier for her when perhaps things aren't going great early on. And a good job by Fordham to bounce back with a good offensive second quarter.
And Harbison back into the game for St. Louis. And a foul is going to be called on the ensuing possession inside off the ball. It's going to be Caitlin Downey trying to defend Smith Traore in the post. And head coach Stephanie Gately continues to talk up these officials, feeling like this has been called one-sided so far. Nonetheless, it'll be Harbison triggering underneath the near block. Floated all the way up top for Ken, who's defended by Flood back into the game for Fordham. They work it around Harbison left wing to the far block for Smith Traore. Back out it goes, a left wing three, too strong off the back iron. And that's going to be grabbed by Flood for Fordham. Carpel the other way, chance to cut it to a one possession game. As it's down, he's finding DeWolf on the back cut to the right side, and she banks it home. A 9-0 run for Fordham, 27-24, 2.5 to play in the first half.
And again, the key, the movement without the basketball, a great cut by Anna DeWolf. We know the ability for Caitlin Dowdy to find the open man, and she does an excellent job there.
Smith-Triori, right short corner. Two dribbles, spins to the left hand, goes up short. Nicely defended by Downey, who snags the rebound on the edge of the restricted area. And Fordham with a chance to tie the game on this possession with 2 minutes to go in the second quarter. It is Haramaya left wing, bounces it for Flood. Skip pass back, Haramaya left wing. Fakes the three, drives inside. Back up top, Downey. She tries a left wing three. That one's short. Rebound grabbed inside by Flood. Kick back out, Haramaya. She'll try a three, and she hits! Kendall Haramaya, the left wing three, a 12-0 run for Fordham, and we're tied at 27.
Fordham doing an outstanding job on the glass. That time it's Matilda Flood with the effort, grabbing the offensive rebound, and Haramaya finally gets one to go. Fordham continuing that strong offensive performance in the second quarter.
Up top, it's Warren, drives right side of the lane, pulls up from the elbow on a jump shot too short, and the rebound inside for Haramaya. So Fordham can take the lead on this possession, 1:20 to go in the first half. As Carpel motions front court left. Knocked out of her hands initially by Warren. Able to save it. No, they're going to say her foot was on the line. And we'll go back to St. Louis with 74 seconds to play in this opening half. It's Warren being replaced by Julia Martinez.
And that one looked like it might have been a tough call against Fordham. Perhaps my vantage point not the best considering our circumstances. But I wasn't so sure that Sarah Carpel stepped out there.
It's Kent at the right elbow. Backs things up with a minute to play. Smith-Triori to the left hand. Goes up. No, can't get it to fall. Rebound batted underneath and off of the leg of Martinez out of bounds. Fordham will get it back with exactly 60 seconds to go, and this is the ideal opportunity for a two-for-one.
For sure. And another story as this first half has progressed for Fordham, the defense from Caitlin Downey on Smith-Triori after she was able to get a couple of tough looks to go early. They've really done a nice job in this second quarter of shutting her down.
Carpel dribbles to the left wing, hands off for DeWolf, backs up to the top of the key, bounces it inside down. He faces up at the left elbow, and now gets it out for DeWolf straight on. Attacks right side of the lane, kicks it out. McLaughlin, wide open, right corner three. She's got it! What a close of this first half for Fordham. McLaughlin for three, and the Rams lead by three, 30-27, 30 seconds to go in the half.
And in the first quarter, there was a lid on the bucket, and then it rains, it pours in the second half, and Fordham doing an excellent job. Again, an open look on that perimeter they're able to create, and Katie McLaughlin comes through with the goods, knocking down the shot.
Martinez at the logo for the Billikens, 10 to shoot, 14 to play in the first half. Martinez to the far wing, looks up top. She's got Kent with five to shoot, gets a screen right. Thinks about the three, now launches one, a prayer, gets it, can't get it to go. It's off to the left, a shot clock violation with 3 seconds to go, and Fordham will get it underneath their own basket. Looking to see if they can get another basket before time expires. The inbound to Carpel, comes back for DeWolf with 1 second, floats one at the buzzer from half court, can't get it to go, it's short, and that's how the first half comes to an end, and what a finish. 15-0 run for Fordham. They lead 30-27 at the break. Interviews coming up at halftime. We'll be right back.
Be sure to follow WFUV Sports on all of our social media platforms. At WFUV Sports on Twitter, at WFUV underscore sports on Instagram, and WFUV Sports on Facebook and YouTube. WFUV Sports, home to New York's longest running sports call-in show and the flagship station of Fordham Athletics.
Welcome to another AD update inside the Rose Hill Gym alongside Fordham Interim Director of Athletics, Ed Cole, Emmanuel Bavari with you. Ed, Happy New Year.
Happy New Year, Manny, and a belated happy birthday to you as well. We did not forget that. The holidays took over some of your birthday celebration, but hopefully you enjoyed it.
Appreciate it, Ed. Let's start with the obvious. Hoop season underway, and the men's basketball team falls to GW 71-47.
head coach Jeff Neubauer talked a lot about how the team faced some challenges booting up, getting ready to start the season. What's your reaction to the men's performance?
You know, obviously exciting to have our men's basketball team back in play, excited to kick off the Atlantic 10 season against GW this past week. Obviously difficult month for the men's basketball program in terms of dealing with COVID, dealing with two trips of quarantine, an extended amount of positives for our young men and our staff. As you know, Manny, the first three games were canceled against us by opponents who had positives. The last four non-conference games were canceled by us due to positives. So a ton of learnings, ton of challenges, ton of adversity for our young men having to go through quarantine or obviously recover. As you know, we've talked about it all semester long. The last really 8 months, 9 months of our conversations have been on the health and safety of our student athletes. And that's what we did this entire month of December, since really Thanksgiving and the start of basketball season. So unfortunate to not have the non-conference games for our men, but happy that we're moving towards getting up to 100%, back to full steam. A little bit of rust in game one, of course, and obviously a little bit of more buildup in terms of getting our men back to physical peak. But we're optimistic about the future, and hopefully now the worst is behind us, fingers crossed, in terms of COVID, and an opportunity for our men to really focus now on the conference season and for our staff to really be able to now focus more about preparing for games and less about some of the COVID challenges that we've had to deal with.
We referenced it before in terms of the men's team. COVID-19 continues to be a big threat around the world on campus here at Fordham. What's an update on some of the efforts you and the athletic department are making to thwart that threat?
A lot of time and attention going into the updates, whether that be from the CDC and their adaptations to new regulations, whether being for a positive COVID or a quarantine. So that's helpful in terms of some of the days and movements. Now it's a 10-day quarantine. New York State has adapted those guidelines, which is good for us in terms of our university location. A lot of time being set towards now January of 2021 and the welcoming back of our other student athletes. As you know, Manny, between fall sports, normal winter and spring seasons, a lot of action here in the spring. So we've been spending a lot of time in terms of move back in, quarantine process in terms of those that are outside of the bordering states, as well as testing protocol, which is going to be aggressive and continue to look at three times a week for our student athletes in season and preparing for February starts, which actually gets going with volleyball. So volleyball will be getting started February 8th off the top of my head. And so we'll be up and running with other sports here while basketball continues to take place.
Looking ahead to 2021, this, as we're recording the first day of the new year, a lot of people thrilled to get 2020 out of the way and turn the page towards the new year. Ed, any New Year's resolutions for Fordham Athletics?
New Year's resolutions for Fordham Athletics. Well, though we are all excited to turn the page on 2020, I must say it was obviously an incredible learning experience, a lot of adversity, a lot of perseverance from our staff, from our student athletes, from our coaches. Couldn't be more proud of how we got through the past semester. And I think that ability to overcome challenges, to find solutions, to collaborate, the silver linings of us coming together as a department and helping each other mentally, emotionally, physically during these challenging times, are making us that much stronger going into 2021. So I'm really excited and honestly really motivated by our department, our student athletes, and a lot of things we've overcome are gonna make us that much stronger and better in 2021. So their ability to overcome COVID, mental health issues, the way we bonded together, social injustice, which you know, political unrest, all the things we've adapted and overcome in 2020, I think is gonna make us that much stronger of an athletics department in 2021. It gives me a lot of motivation and hope for our future and a lot to be excited about.
Ed, let me hit you personally. New Year's resolution, have you mapped it out on the drawing board at home?
You know, personally, it's always a challenge to come up with these. For me, it's always the physical fitness piece, trying to find more time to get healthy. And I have the Peloton at home and looking to do some more exercise bike here on campus. My wife's a tennis player, was in college, so trying to play more tennis with her. It's always the physical fitness and not so much just the health piece, but also the mental health piece. How about yourself, Manny? What are yours?
Wow, putting me on the spot there. I think I, on a broad note, I want to stay in the moment in everything I do. Also, as a senior, looking for employment. So we'll see how where that leads. We'll see where that goes. But as I look towards 2021, a lot to be excited about, certainly.
Well, you're going to be a hot commodity come free agent market this offseason once you graduate. And I feel very confident about that. And I promise something we'll work together on.
This won't look good, but maybe a one-year flyer. Maybe not the 5-6 year deal, but the one-year flyer here. Ed, always appreciate it. Happy New Year, and best to you and your family.
Manny, you're the best. Happy New Year as well.
Welcome to our women's basketball recap here on Running Rampant. Jackson Heil joined by head coach Stephanie Gately and mom as
Hi,
well.
Hi, mom.
Coach, happy holidays, first of all. How was your Merry Christmas and New Year?
I mean, it was, as most people, very subdued. Went down to visit my mom, spent some time with her, which was great. And Coop came home, but Dutch and DC had games, so they couldn't come home. So very quiet, but again, family time, you always appreciate it.
Good to hear, and let's focus on what's happened over the last 2 weeks. You had a game against Davidson, which didn't go too well for you guys. You guys give up 79 points on your home floor, but the response has been excellent since then. 42 points, 32 points, 47 points, the total outputs in the last three games. What has been this response from your team, and how proud of you have you been of them?
Super proud. I mean, obviously, you know, the way things worked out, it was great that we had Albany right after Davidson, even though that wasn't planned. But that gave us a chance to kind of get ourselves together defensively before we went for the break. And then when we came back, you know, I said to the kids, these games now are all 50-50 games. So it's going to come down to the details, defensive details, who wins the rebounding battles, and who does the little things better.
Let's talk about today's game, because we are reporting this just after a win over GW, 53-47. You get a big shot late from your superstar, Anna DeWolf. How impressed have you been with the way that she has progressed over this year? Because, listen, she had a really good start. Team's defending her a lot differently now in conference when coming in.
Yeah, I mean, of course, because last year, you know, Bryson and who's three, when she played for us, you know, was the go-to, right? Yep. So we had to be in a situation where Anna now has to take on a different role. Kendall has to take on a different role. And I thought today, Caitlin Downey was spectacular. I thought she did a fantastic job. And we made some big plays down the stretch that were key. Lake Jonathan made a big stretch, made a big play defensively. So everybody's contributing. It's like it's success by committee.
I want to talk about your front court a little bit, because Caitlin Downey, like you mentioned, has been a monster on the rebounds. And also, Meg Johnson's been probably the best offensive rebounder in the Atlantic 10. You moved her into the starting lineup against Hofstra, and that's remained the same since then. How impressed have you been with her development, specifically taking on a more advanced role this year?
It's just that her work ethic has really paid off. I mean, she's been coming in with Coach Sonia for so many times, and I think that all that repetition has really started to pay off. Plus, she's just a great kid and a great leader. She does a fantastic job giving everybody energy. I've told her more than once this week that she inspires me every day because of the way she brings it every day. I mean, right now she is number one in the conference in offensive rebounding. Caitlin's number two in overall rebounding. Obviously, 18 rebounds today goes a long way as well.
Coach, we were talking before this about kind of the long toll that this season has taken, and you got a very well-deserved off day tomorrow. How do you feel like your team has handled everything that's been thrown at them this year?
I mean, there's been, knock on wood, but no, everybody's been negative, you know, so I think that speaks a lot of the pride the kids have in wanting to play, you know, and I think it's tough, you know, especially I have my own child in college, and I know how it affects him with Coop being at Richmond, and it's just a different vibe, you know, and I feel bad for the kids, so this is what they look forward to, so that's why I tell them, every day before we play a game, I'm like, your victory already started by being able to play. Just go out and enjoy and have fun.
Coach, I mentioned mom before, but she is here right with us, and you had her on the sidelines today. Even though she isn't able to be here in the stands, how important is it to just have this face covering of her on the sidelines with you?
Well, she's 95. She has 21 grandchildren, wow, and 11 great-grandchildren, and she's just been somebody that's inspired me my whole life. And so I felt today, we usually do a guest coach, so we thought we would add her to being our guest coach, and she brought us some luck, so it worked.
Coach, let's look ahead. You got a really tough road slate coming up. URI, UMass this weekend. The following weekend comes a test against Dayton as well. How do you feel like you guys are prepared to play on the road this year? Because it's something that wasn't maybe your strong suit last year, but again, you have a new team this year. How do you feel like they're ready to fare against this road test?
I don't think you know until you're there. Uh-huh. You know, I think the Stony Brook game was a game in which we saw that we responded well to the challenge of being on the road. Plus, with having no fans or limited fans, I think makes a big difference, especially in the case of like at a Dayton that gets a great crowd, because that can be a game changer when that momentum shifts. So for us, I mean, I'm looking forward to the challenge. It's a tough stretch for us, but we're going to have to play them, and we got to be ready to take our best shot.
Last question before we wrap up. A lot of college coaches this year have talked about making road games home games by what you can do on the bench. Just from sitting by the bench, your bench has been really active and loud. How do you feel like you can use that as an advantage going on the road against some really good teams like a Dayton and like a UMass?
Again, I think the intangibles are huge in our program. So little things make a big difference. And in our bench, our kids, like I said, every time, you know, it's kind of cliche. People say, oh, you know, we're family, we're a team. But this team really is. I mean, they really care about each other on and off the court. So what you see is a team that's really, really invested in each other. So I have no doubt that they will be part of our 50-50 in our intangibles.
Coach, thank you so much for the time. Congrats on this 3-game win streak, and best of luck going forward.
Thanks. Go Rams. Happy New Year.
This is the One-on-One Halftime Report, presented by support.wfuv.org and WFUV Sports, home to New York's longest-running sports call-in show and the flagship station of Fordham Athletics.
This is the One-on-One Halftime Report. Jackson Heil alongside Nick DeLuca. 30-27 Fordham on top at halftime. And it was quite a stretch in that second quarter for the Rams. They closed the half out on a 15-0 run. A lot of the damage coming from behind the arc. 5 of 8 from three in that second quarter. But you would never guess how things started by looking at that final score, Nick, because if you thought a team was going to come out rusty, it was probably going to be St. Louis, but they jumped out to a 12-point lead, but it was Fordham's 3-point shooting and led by Anna DeWolf with her 12 points that got them back in the game.
Yeah, Fordham doing a much better job on the perimeter to create those open looks. And Anna DeWolf, the beneficiary, and then on the payoff end a couple of times with some great passes from Caitlin Downey as well, and them using that perimeter success to open things up, sort of driving to the basket as well. So they were really able to find a way to manufacture some offense to get themselves going in that second quarter after really struggling in the first. And then you can see the stress that it puts on other teams defensively. When you're starting to hit from three, you can open things up, and it's a back cut for Anna DeWolf, and she's got the easy two. So it's really just an excellent job by Fordham adjusting, finding a way to, you know, just mentality-wise, we're going to keep shooting. Mm-hmm. We're not going to freak out. We're going to stick with our game plan and then just doing a better job of opening things up on the offensive side.
18 of their 36 shot attempts came from behind the arc. And there were a few things offensively that stuck out to me in that half. One, Caitlin Downey has 5 rebounds and 5 assists, and she hasn't shot the ball well all that great recently. Just 1 of 6 from the field in this one, 1 of 4 from three. But Nick, I don't know if there's a better passing big in this country than her, and she's putting it on display in this first half. And also, Kendall Jeremiah, 2 fouls early in this one. She plays 17 minutes in that first half in foul trouble. Very impressed, by the way, she was able to adjust after picking up those 2 early fouls. And she was big for Fordham, 7 points in that first half as well.
For sure. And then it sort of begs the question on the other side for Lisa Stone, where was the potential to attack Kendall Jeremiah and try and get her further into foul trouble? But on the positive side, sticking with Fordham here, yes, absolutely great job for her to stick out of the trouble. And we know what she means to this team on the offensive side. On the defensive side, she just creates so many matchup issues for teams trying to defend because of how good she can be both rebounding the basketball and also, you know, off the dribble and everything that she can do on offense. So she's so crucial and so good for her to be able to stay out of foul trouble. And then a credit also to Coach Gately. You trust your player, and then Jeremiah follows through on that trust, and then Fordham with a 15-0 run. That's the result, and they're looking good at halftime.
For St. Louis, it's Harbison with 6 points, but they're led by Rachel Kent. 10 points, 4 of 6 from the field, 2 of 3 from behind the arc. A preseason All-A-10 third team this year. She was on the All-A-10 rookie team. She's coming off her worst performance of her college career. 0 points against Bradley, 0 of 4 from the field. She turned the ball over 3 times, was in foul trouble, but a nice response by the sophomore, and she's the reason the Billikens are in this one.
Well, she's certainly a better player than that effort would show, and she is also kind of like Kendall Jeremiah, a player who gives teams problems at the matchup. She, at 5'11", is certainly taller than a number of players that she's going to match up with, but also with the speed and the ability to shoot, is that wing player that sort of swings things and is someone you have to be alert for at all times if you're on defense. So she's been very good in that first half. She was very good last year, as I mentioned, against Fordham as well. So the Rams are going to have to pay attention to trying to contain her, although they did and ending the half on the 15-0 run, a better job of that towards the end of the second quarter.
So it'll be the Billikens going right to left to start the half. It's an immediate feed into Smith Traore. Gets in the paint, goes up with the right hand and scores. And that immediately ends the drought. 30-29 Fordham on top. The 15-0 run is halted. It is Carpell on the left wing for Fordham. Rams in their maroon tops as she finds the Wolf cutting right side. Out for Downey. Wide open, a right corner three. All nylon. Caitlin Downey from downtown off the feed from DeWolf. Rams back in front by four.
And again, it's that key, the ball movement to free up Downey on the perimeter. And she makes no mistake. She's wide open. But that's a great job of moving without the basketball by Fordham on offense.
Clark feeds Smith Traore out to Ken on the wing into the corner for Harbison. She tries a three. Too strong. Rebound grab by Downey and pushed ahead for DeWolf. Rams left to right will look to potentially slow things down. DeWolf tries to find a back cutting Downey. And the pass was deflected out of bounds off Downey last. And it looks like the officials are going to discuss this one. And they're going to change the call. They're going to say Kent got the last piece. So Fordham will keep it. Minute gone in this third quarter, 24 to shoot.
That was Caitlin Downey's initial reaction saying, yeah, there's no way that ball touched me. And live, that didn't look like it either. So, yeah, Fordham should keep that one. They do.
Carpell will inbound underneath. She bounces it for Downey and now finds Haramaya left wing. Thought about the three. Now kicks it back out for Downey with 15 to shoot. Rams work it around the perimeter. It's Carpell up top. Haramaya fakes the three, drives to the foul line, pulls up on a jump shot. Can't get it to go, too strong. Rebound batted underneath Smith Traore with the last touch, and the pressure from Downey gets Fordham an extra possession.
And it's the hustle and the little things that Coach Gately always talks about that we've documented Caitlin Downey there.
The inbound Carpell to Haramaya in the short corner. Her 16-footer is short, and Smith Traore has it for St. Louis. Billikens the other way. 90 seconds gone in this third quarter. As coming off the screen is Clark. Gets the left block. Kicks out Harbison. Thought about the three. Now attacks baseline. Jump stop center of the lane. Goes up too strong into the left. Rebound batted into the corner. Harbison tries to save it, but it only goes into the hands of Downey. Floated ahead for Carpell. Into the right corner, McLaughlin. Thought about a three. Now it's Haramaya straight on. 20 to shoot for Fordham. As head coach Stephanie Gately calls out a play. It's bounce for Carpell, right wing. Finds Haramaya with 10 to shoot. Spin to the lane. Gets underneath. Right-handed layup is good. Off the glass and in. Kendall Haramaya extends the Fordham lead to 6. 35-29 under 8 minutes to go in the third.
The matchup problems that Kendall Haramaya can create. The shot fake ball to the floor, and she does an excellent job on the rest.
On the feet, it's Smith Traore. Skip pass. Right wing Martinez. All alone. She'll fire a three. Can't get it to go too strong. Rebound Smith Traore underneath. She'll try again. That one won't go. Rebound Martinez. Billikens with a third chance. It's Clark center of the lane. Floats it up with the right hand and sinks it home. Third chance points for the Billikens. 35-31, 7.5 to go in the third quarter.
Yeah, and that generally doesn't happen as well as Fordham has rebounded the basketball throughout this year. A rare sort of lapse on the box out, and St. Louis takes advantage.
Zone defense for the Billikens to the right corner. DeWolf, she'll try a three. Off the heel, no good. Rebound Downey in the far corner. Fresh 20 for Fordham. DeWolf flashes to the left elbow. Gets underneath, tries to go up, and she's fouled before the shot is called. The shot did go in from DeWolf, but nonetheless, Fordham will keep it. 7:05 to play third quarter. 35-31, Rams on top. Brooke Flowers into the game for St. Louis. So the Billikens opting to go big on this scenario as they go back into man defense. The inbound goes to Haramaya. Gets inside. Kicks it out right corner. McLaughlin tries a three. It's short. And the rebound swatted out underneath by Downey. It'll go back to St. Louis with under 7 minutes to go in the third.
Yeah, interesting to see St. Louis go big in this sort of situation because of how effective Fordham has been on the perimeter. Perhaps they feel like they'll do a better job of closing out, but you'd have to figure that that'll certainly give Fordham more of an advantage shooting from the outside.
Flowers gives it off for Kent, left wing, 30 feet from the hoop. Attacks to the top of the key. Hands for Smith Traore. Finds Harbison. Attacking right side. 8-foot pull-up jumper. It's short. Rebound knocked loose underneath by Flowers. And it will touch the baseline to go back to Fordham. But St. Louis looking to attack the glass. And what's also interesting, Nick, St. Louis back in zone yet again.
Yeah, and again, because Fordham has shot the three ball so well, that's sort of what you're giving up in zone. And it's surprising. But at the same time, this can also be a conditioning thing.
Downey, a left wing three. Oh, man. She's got it. Caitlin Downey with her second three of the half. Largest lead for Fordham. 38-31 with 6:15 to go in the third.
And the great movement on the outside again. Caitlin Downey knocking down the open shot. Fordham doing a great job of creating.
Up top, it's Smith Traore. Largest deficit thus far for the Billikens. To the near corner, Martinez finds Flowers near block. Spin to the left hand. Finds a cutting Smith Traore. Great pass underneath. Smith Traore can't finish. Rebound for Flowers. Able to gather on the near block. Kicks it up top for Harbison. Immediately attacks left side into the post for Smith Traore. Spins back to the left hand far block. Kicks it out Martinez. Across it goes Harbison. Pulls up from the foul line. A jump shot. She's got it. That is her bread and butter, the mid-range game for Kaija Harbison. 38-33, 5.5 to go in the third.
And an excellent job by Kaija Harbison because that possession did not go very well for St. Louis. She's able to get it on the perimeter and create her own shot, knock it down.
Jeremiah inside, Downey the layup and one. Picking the zone apart, it's Caitlin Downey red hot to start the third, and she'll have a chance for the old-fashioned three at the line. 40-33, Fordham on top with 5:20 to play in the third.
And an excellent entry by Kendall Jeremiah right there to Downey, absorbing the contact off the glass. And she's so good.
Caitlin Downey, 11 points now, 3 of 6 from behind the arc. And she's also got those 8 rebounds with 5 assists as well. Downey, 3 dribbles. Make it 2 more. And the free throw on its way. Rattles in and out. Rebound batted out to the far wing and tracked down by Martinez for St. Louis. Billikens look to push. It's Kent on the left wing. Loses it in the corner, but she's able to track it down. Picks up her dribble, however, and bounces it to the post for Flowers. Goes inside, goes to the right hand, gets it up and scores. Brooke Flowers over the top of McLaughlin from 5 feet away. And the deficit back to 5 for St. Louis, halfway mark of the third quarter. 40-35, Fordham on top. Billikens back in man defense. It's Carpell at the top of the key to Jeremiah left wing. Thought about the three. Now we'll attack baseline on Flowers. Crosses over to right. Spins inside. Hesitates. Goes up with the right hand. Then finishes. Oh, what a pretty move by Kendall Jeremiah, the junior. 42-35. Fordham leads.
And we have detailed how important Kendall Jeremiah is to this offensive attack. She shows it right there. Great aggressiveness. Going to the basket and able to create their own shot.
4.5 to play third quarter. A 7-point lead for Fordham as Harbison has it right wing for St. Louis. 10 to shoot for the Billikens. Harbison drives, pulls up from 12 feet. Can't get it to go. Smith Traore inside the second chance. And she finishes. And that's where the points are coming for St. Louis. Inside with the size. 5-point lead for Fordham. 4:10 to go in the third.
Well, there is the one advantage of going big. And it is perhaps problematic for them defensively. Offensively, they're finding a little bit of room there and doing a good job.
Left wing Jeremiah. She'll try a triple. Can't get it to go short. And Kent has it in the paint for St. Louis. Billikens looking to cut it to a one-possession game. It's Smith Traore, right elbow. Hands off for Harbison. Attacks left. Back out Smith Traore. A right elbow jump shot. Too strong, and Carpell has the weak side rebound for Fordham. Under 4 minutes of play. In transition comes to Wolf. Gets to the basket and scores as she snuck by Martinez. And the Rams lead back to 7 with 3.5 to go in the quarter.
And Anna DeWolf can be deadly in transition. She does an excellent job there, pushing the pace, blowing past the defender, and it's an easy 2.
14 points for Anna DeWolf. It's Smith Traore on the right elbow. Fakes the jump shot. Now surges right side of the lane. Kicks it out. It's intercepted by McLaughlin. Tried to get it for Kent, and Fordham has possession. It's Jeremiah straight on. Fakes the handoff. Out to Carpell in the corner. Can't handle the pass. Ball on the floor. It's scooped up by McLaughlin. She's searching for options, and a jump ball is going to be called. And the possession arrow will stay with Fordham. And they'll have possession when we come back. A back-and-forth affair from Scheifetz Arena in St. Louis. Fordham 44, St. Louis 37 here on WFUV Sports.
Fordham's next home game is January 22nd when they take on St. Bonaventure. Tip-off from the Rose Hill Gym is at 2 p.m. and we'll be on with the one-on-one pregame report at 1:55 on WFUVsports.org. The men's next scheduled game is Wednesday, January 20th, when they take on Davidson. Tip-off is at 2 p.m. with the one-on-one pregame at 1:55 on 90.7 FM and WFUVsports.org. With no fans in the stands, be sure to listen to every Fordham basketball game this season on WFUV Sports. Fordham Rams basketball at the Rose Hill Gym.
And Fordham playing in the Rose Hill Gym right now, facing off with UMass on the men's side. They trail big early in this one, 37. UMass on top with 6 minutes to go in the first half. But again, in Seifert's Arena, a different story for the women's team. They lead 44-37, 3 minutes to go in the third quarter. And the star of this frame, Nick DeLuca, none other than Caitlin Downey.
For sure. And she has had her fingerprints all over this game, both offensively and defensively, doing an excellent job of moving the basketball and finding open players to, you know, for easy buckets is really what it is and what it amounts to. Some great cuts by Anna DeWolf and Downey finding her, but also getting it going, shooting the basketball and creating those open looks for her. And she has knocked them down certainly. And then also in the rebounding game, right, and getting Fordham those extra opportunities. So really an excellent job by Caitlin Downey, especially in this second half. And she has just been everywhere for Fordham, and they've certainly needed it.
Kendall Jeremiah, also a big piece of the equation. 11 points for her, 4 rebounds to go with 2 assists. Anna DeWolf also with a spectacular performance thus far. She leads all scorers with 14, an efficient 6 of 12 from the field, 2 of 4 from behind the arc. But this is what you expected with this trio this year. You know that they can score in bunches, and today it didn't go well early for them. But listen, things have picked up, especially since the second quarter, and for them to all be in double figures with 3 minutes left in the third quarter, a great sign for Fordham, and they needed it.
Well, it's the recipe for them to win, right? That's where the scoring you would hope comes from. And we detailed it early when they were stuck at 5 and, okay, well, it's Matilda Flood getting on the scoreboard and Sarah Carpell, but you're wondering where the primary options are going to come from. And they have certainly stepped it up as we got into the second quarter and then continued the hot shooting here in the third. It's been that trio, and they are so crucial to what Fordham wants to do.
18 to shoot off the held ball. Timeout as DeWolf has it on the right wing. Gives off for Downey. Now bounce back for DeWolf. Drives right side. Out for Downey. A right wing three. Oh, man. There's another one. Caitlin Downey on fire. 11 points in the quarter and Fordham's largest lead. It's 47-37 with 2:40 to play in the third.
And such a weapon when she gets going like this, because you got to account for the passing and account for all the things that she can do on the offensive side. Such a weapon for Fordham, Caitlin Downey.
Harbis in the left corner tries a three. That one's too strong. And there's Caitlin Downey with another rebound for Fordham. Working on another double-double. She has 9 rebounds in this one to go with 14 points. It's Carpell right wing. Up top for McLaughlin. Fakes the pass inside. 15 to shoot for Fordham. A 10-point lead for the Rams. DeWolf on that left wing. Crosses over. Tries to drive baseline. And a foul is going to be called on Clark. It's going to be a hand check against the junior. And it will stay with Fordham. 20 to shoot for the Rams. 47-37 they lead. And they have really started to light it up from behind the arc as Marissa Warren comes back into the game for Julia Martinez.
And interested to see as this game goes on what the conditioning looks like for St. Louis. I mentioned that a little bit earlier, but when you haven't played in 41 days, it's going to be tough going down the stretch.
Downey faces up on a jump shot inside. It's short, and the rebound is grabbed by Clark for St. Louis. Under 2 minutes to play, third quarter. 10-point lead for Fordham, 47-37 on top of St. Louis. It's Warren driving to the right wing, defended by DeWolf, as she kicks it up to the wing for Harbison. Skip pass for Clark. Curls right side of the lane. Out for Warren it goes. She attacks inside. Nice bounce pass for Flowers. Goes up with the right hand. Too strong. And there's rebound number 10 for Caitlin Downey, her third straight double-double.
Not much left to say on that one, and an excellent job by Anna DeWolf coming over to help to force that shot into a rush, and then Downey there as she has been all day underneath the basket.
Carpell in the right corner for Downey, fakes the three, now drives to the elbow, finds DeWolf cutting off the screen, gets inside, righty scoop layup is short, and the rebound one-handed grab by Warren. Looks to push the tempo up the near wing, attacks right side of the lane, goes up with the right hand, swatted away by Flood, the freshman with the denial on that right block, and will stay with St. Louis. 65 seconds to play in the third quarter, 22 to shoot. Ball into the hands of Warren. Floats it up top for Kent, right wing. Looks to get it to Harbison, who's defended closely by Carpell. Back to Kent, right wing. She'll try a three. That one's good. Rachel Kent off the flare screen. A big-time three for the Billikens, and the deficit cut to 7, 47-40, 50 seconds to go in the third.
And Rachel Kent coming through again for St. Louis has been so good for them and keeping them in the ballgame right now.
McLaughlin hands off top of the key for DeWolf, and she surveys options. Jab step, now attacks right side of the lane, gets inside, floats it up short off the front iron, and Flowers has the rebound for St. Louis. 3 second margin between game and shot clock. It's Warren on that far wing. Defended closely by DeWolf. Gets a screen right from Flowers. Hesitates. Stops. 8 foot pull up jump shot. It's short. Rebound grabbed by Flowers and a foul called on DeWolf trying to battle for the boards underneath. And that will all but secure that St. Louis can hold for the final shot. 0.4 differential between game and shot clock. Warren underneath the far block. Gets it up top for Kent. Scarpell tries to deny Harbison. Now she collects it. Edge of that Billikens logo with 13 to play in the quarter. Carpell backs up to the three-point line. Harbison starts her drive. It goes to the right side. Pull-up elbow, jump shot. All nylon. Harbison with the bucket. A five-point lead for Fordham. Time expires on the third quarter. And that will bring us to the fourth. A good one developing at Seifert's Arena. 47-42. Fordham on top. 10 minutes to play in St. Louis.
Be sure to check out all of our latest podcasts on WFUVsports.org or wherever you get your shows, including NFL Friday, Nosebleeds, Pick and Pod, 5-on-3, College Gridiron, and FUV FC. Also, our newest edition, Off the Air, diving into the station's legacy with its most prominent alumni. WFUV Sports, home to New York's longest-running sports call-in show and the flagship station of Fordham Athletics.
We got a good one going to the wire at Seifert's Arena. 47-42, Fordham on top of St. Louis, fourth quarter. Set to begin in just a moment. Jackson Heil, Nick DeLuca here on YouTube Live, our WFUV Sports page. Shout out to our producer today, Alex Wolves, for getting us on the air. Shout out to Nick as well for setting things up on the remote front. But again, we can't be in St. Louis due to COVID restrictions. We are at the Rose Hill campus, just a little while away from the Rose Hill gym. But nonetheless, Fordham holding on to a five-point lead. They led by as many as 10 in the fourth, but Nick, if there's a good sign for St. Louis, it's that Kaija Harbison finally starting to get going. We saw her hit that elbow jump shot at the end of the quarter. She's got 10 points, 4 of 12 from the field, but Fordham held her in check for a while. They got to hold her in check for 10 more minutes if they want to come away with conference win number 4.
And that's the difficulty of the whole equation here when you're talking about a player like Kaija Harbison. She is someone who I would hold in the esteem of an Anna DeWolf when you're talking about Fordham, right? So it's not about stopping her. You're not going to shut her down for an entire game. It's about doing your best to make things as difficult as possible for her to be successful. And Fordham has done that for the most part. 10 points on 4 of 12 from the field. That's you'll sign up for that, but that's through three quarters. So Now it's about doing a good job in the fourth and limiting her looks and opportunities and making life difficult for her in trying to be successful. And Fordham has done a good enough job of that so far. And now it's about finding ways to disrupt. I think that's the biggest thing going forward in the final 10 minutes.
The main source of offense for St. Louis has been Rachel Kent, 13 points, 5 of 7 from the field, 3 of 4 behind the arc. And when they've gotten her open off those flare screens, she's done a really good job of just catching it, releasing it. And she's made some big shots, including one to cut the deficit from 10 to 7 before Harbison got that late bucket.
Yeah, for sure. And again, as I've said, just a matchup problem for Fordham at 5'11" and the way that she moves in the speed and has kept St. Louis in this game right now. If not for her, they'd be in big trouble.
So off the restarted St. Louis ball moving right to left up top. It is Rachel Kent. Kicks it out for Warren on that far wing. 15 to shoot for the Billikens as Warren gets the block. Out it goes for Clark in the corner. Defended closely by Flubb with 10 to shoot. Picks up her dribble, bounces it for Kent on the right wing. Works her way left to right to the far elbow. She fires a jump shot. It's short. Rebound grabbed underneath by the freshman Flood, and Fordham gets possession. Left to right go the Rams in their road maroon tops. It's Carpell, Jeremiah, Flood, DeWolf, and Downey for Fordham. Jeremiah top of the key. Floats it out. Downey left corner. She'll try a three. She's got another one. How about Caitlin Downey lighting things up from behind the arc? 17 points for her, an 8-point lead for Fordham, opening minute of the fourth.
And so good again, Fordham creating the space on the perimeter. Caitlin Downey just doing an outstanding job of making the shots.
And Flowers answers on the other end, an and one in the post on Downey. 50-44, St. Louis on top. Flowers to the line for one more. And great move, just cutting across the lane on Downey. And Flowers, such an interesting piece of this team. As a freshman, blocked 68 shots, is second all-time already as a junior in blocked shots at 6'5". As her free throw is pure, 50-45. Fordham on top of St. Louis as the Billikens come out with some front court pressure. Up to head to DeWolf, left corner, wide open for three. Why not? Anna DeWolf from behind the arc. She's got 17 herself, and Fordham's lead restored to 8.
And great ball movement by Kendall Jeremiah, breaking the press easily, and boom to Anna DeWolf for the wide open look. She knocks it down.
Up top, it's Harbison defended by Flood. 8.5 minutes to play in the fourth. 53-45, Fordham on top. To Flowers it goes. Out to Smith-Traore. A left elbow jump shot. Too strong. Jeremiah skies for the rebound for Fordham. Good stop again for the Rams. They look to get this lead back to double digits. It's Carpell walking it up left to right into the front court. Harbison defending. Billikens in man defense with 15 to shoot. Rams take a while to get into their offense. It's Flood left wing. Drives baseline on Clark. Looks to back her down. Gets in the lane to the right hand. She lays it up. Can't get it to fall. Rebound loose in the far corner. Knocked out of bounds by Smith-Traore. And it will stay with Fordham. Sarah Carpell forcing pressure on the glass.
And good effort again. And it's something that we've detailed throughout this game from a number of players. This time it's Sarah Carpell. But making life difficult for St. Louis on the glass, something that Fordham has been so good at all year. But again, this time Carpell forcing and getting the extra possession for the Rams.
Inbound goes to Jeremiah, left wing. Bounce pass to a back cutting DeWolf. Floater from 10, and she's got it. Anna DeWolf with 19. Fordham's lead back to 10 with 7:45 to play.
And the Anna DeWolf basket cuts have been so effective in the second half. Kendall Jeremiah, the good pass for the easy two.
And a foul called on the floor. It's going to be on Flood. She tried to pressure Smith-Traore inside. 7:42 to go, fourth quarter. 55-45, Fordham on top. And DeWolf and Downey continue to cause problems for the Billikens. It's floated up top for Kent. Now to left wing Smith-Traore. Skips it across, looking for Kent on the flare screen. Off her fingertips, out of bounds in front of the St. Louis bench. And Fordham gets possession right back.
The defense in this second half in particular has been really good for Fordham, forcing the turnovers. That's a tough pass and sort of an error that St. Louis will chalk up. But Fordham, after St. Louis was able to do things pretty well in that first half, done a good job defensively here in the second.
Jeremiah drives to the right elbow. Her jump shot short, and Kent has it for St. Louis. Kent the other way, stops at the foul line, pulls up on a J. Can't get it to fall. Rebound bat into the far corner, and a foul is going to be called on the loose ball rebound attempt. It's going to go against St. Louis. Maya Clark booked with the personal. Check that. It's actually going to be Smith-Traore, who was immediately sent to the bench for St. Louis. And Jeremiah will inbound underneath for the Rams. Bounces it for Carpell. No backcourt pressure this time from St. Louis. As we approach 3 minutes gone in this fourth quarter. 10-point advantage for Fordham. They trail by as many as 13 in that first half. It's Carpell bouncing for DeWolf right wing. Looks inside for Jeremiah. And the pass went flying by her out of bounds on the baseline. And St. Louis will get it right back off the Downey turnover.
Fordham has done a good enough job of keeping the turnovers in check. That one's just sort of an errant pass, but on the whole, they've done a good job of taking care of the basketball today.
St. Louis looking to cut into the 10-point deficit. It's Kent driving right side. Pull-up jumper from 10 is short, and the rebound into the hands of Jeremiah near block. Fordham back with it. 6.5 to go in the fourth quarter. As Meg Jonathan gets set to check back into the game for the Rams. Haven't seen much of her in the second half. As it goes to Downey, left corner, 18-footer off the front iron, and Flowers in the restricted area for the rebound for St. Louis. Warren pushing right to left, drive side of the lane, drive, gets inside and lays it up and in over the top of DeWolf, the DePaul transfer. Warren with the bucket, 55-47 as we approach 6 minutes to play in regulation. It is Carpel, top of the key for Fordham. Finds Downey and now bounces the near wing for Jeremiah. Thought about the shot, moves it up top for Flood to the left wing now for DeWolf. Fakes the pass inside. Now drives with the right hand, gets in the lane. Three-footer, gets the roll. Anna DeWolf with another 20-point performance. 21 for her and a 10-point lead for Fordham with 5:45 to go.
And Anna DeWolf using the threat of the three ball to create some space. She goes to the floor, and when she gets the full head of steam going, there's not much that's going to stop her.
Harbison, left side drive, 8 foot pull up is all too strong. And DeWolf has the rebound for Fordham as she races left to right into the front court. DeWolf straight on. Off for Downey. Another three. Oh, yeah. Caitlin Downey unconscious from deep. Largest lead for Fordham. 60-47 with 5:22 to go. A timeout, St. Louis. And the junior captain with 20 points and six threes to go with it. Unbelievable shooting performance from Fordham. And they lead by 13 at this media timeout here on WFUV Sports.
WFUV Sports has welcomed a new podcast to the family, Off the Air, the legacy of WFUV Sports. On the show, we interview some of the brightest talents to come through the WFUV pipeline, from industry legends to rising stars. Our hosts dive into the stories that made their time in the Bronx special. Episode 17 with Knicks public address announcer Mike Walshefsky, along with every episode of Off the Air, can be found on WFUVsports.org as well as our YouTube page. That's Off the Air, the legacy of WFUV Sports, every week on our YouTube page and WFUVsports.org.
Well, what a shooting performance it's been for Fordham today. 12 of 27 from behind the arc, and the main beneficiary, Caitlin Downey, 6 of 9 from 3, 7 of 14 from the field in general. She's got another double-double with 20 points and 10 rebounds. Her and DeWolf combining for 41 points. And listen, we can talk about Anna DeWolf all we want, and we do pretty much every Fordham game, and she's been terrific. But the X factor from Fordham has been the junior Downey stepping up big time.
Yeah, and I think it's a credit to Fordham just in general in showing how many ways they can find to score on offense and win basketball games, right? They're so dangerous because you know that Anna DeWolf is going to be your catalyst, but then is it Downey? Is it Kendall Jeremiah, who has also been able to score in double digits at times? So she has just been all over the floor today, and it's not just shooting the basketball. This has been her best shooting performance of the year for sure, but at the same time, it's been on the glass. It's been moving the basketball. It's been passing. And on defense as well, this has been a complete performance for the junior captain, and Fordham is in position to win this game down the stretch, largely on the shoulders of Caitlin Downey.
She has been in double figures every time they have played St. Louis in her career. And the previous four games, I mean, as a freshman, she went for 16 points, a career high at that point, 12 points in the other meeting. Last year at St. Louis, she had 16 points. At home, she had 13. And now with 20 points in this one, she has been awfully impressive. And she's now four away from her career high, 24 last year against Charlotte. An awesome performance for the Rams, but I think something you mentioned earlier, the defense in the second half has been much improved, and they've pretty much eliminated Kaija Harbison from making much of an impact at all in this one.
Something that's extraordinarily difficult to do, but at some point, if you're St. Louis, you have to make the right play, and Fordham is forcing them out of working through Kaija Harbison. So now it's about finding the secondary scoring that we always talk about, and Fordham is certainly getting from Caitlin Downey and others. And St. Louis hasn't been able to replicate that so far.
A 60-47 lead for Fordham, halfway point of this fourth quarter as it's floated in to Mariana Smith-Traore. Out to the right wing. Warren open for three. Off the front iron. No rebound loose in the paint, and it's grabbed by Kent for St. Louis. Extra opportunity for the Billikens. It's Harbison, left side drive. Gets in the lane. Goes up with the right hand. No, but a foul's going to be called on Meg Jonathan inside, and that'll send Harbison to the line for two. They need her to get going.
Meg Jonathan, not a huge fan of the call. You could see sort of the mouth open, like, what was that? But yes, absolutely. And one of the best ways to get one of your better players involved or back into the flow is getting her to the free throw line. And St. Louis, of course, hoping that will get Harbison going there. But at the same time, Fordham has just done an excellent job of making things difficult.
Yeah, the officials into this today's game, Bob Enterline, Kelsey Reynolds, and Angel Kent. Head coach Stephanie Gately, not a huge fan of the officiating in that first half, but things have seemed to even themselves out a little bit in the second half. And listen, that was going to come with the game eventually. It usually does work itself out, but we do have a stoppage on the floor. 60-47, Fordham on top, exactly 5 minutes to play with Harbison going to the line on the other side of this media timeout. But for Fordham, shooting the ball, I mean, we've seen them have performances like this in the past. And last year, the big one was against Charlotte where they buried 15 threes. They're well on their way to doing that. 12 of 27 from behind the arc in this one. We mentioned Downey being a big factor there, but they've really gotten production from everywhere in addition to their stars. And early on, they didn't have any points in the first quarter from those three alone. DeWolf, Haramaya, and Downey were held scoreless in the third quarter. You look at them now, 21 for DeWolf, 20 for Downey, and 11 for Haramaya. Quite an offensive explosion.
Well, it's a classic case of how it started versus how it's going, and that's been the tale of what's happened for Fordham this afternoon. But to me, it comes down to just creating that motion on the perimeter, mm-hmm. right? Finding ways to free up some of the players, whether it be Downey, whether it be DeWolf, and then working through that into some of the cuts to the basket or driving through the lane. That's, to me, what has been the biggest thing in freeing up this entire offensive attack. When you're able to shoot from three the way they have, and it's been in part the hot shooting, but in part also what they've done to free people up, when you're able to do those two things, it opens up the whole offense. Mm-hmm. It's incredibly difficult to defend. Man doesn't work. Zone doesn't work when you're on and hitting your threes. And it's the classic case. You live by the three, you die by the three. Well, Fordham's living by the three today.
And a lot of them have been open looks too. Like yeah. We can talk about them and their ability to make shots, which is certainly obviously necessary because, listen, you're not going to make every shots every time. And we've seen it
in the
past.
It wasn't happening in the first quarter.
Exactly.
Yeah.
It wasn't. But St. Louis's defense has really taken a step back in these last 25 minutes, starting in that second quarter where Fordham put up 25 points, 17 in the third quarter, already 13 with 5 minutes to play in the fourth. It's been a shooting clinic for the Rams, but you have to think that you talked about potential fatigue setting in for St. Louis, not having played a game in nearly 41 days. To me, it has set in pretty significantly here, and that's where we stand right now.
For sure. And it was something we were talking about with, oh, why are they going big here? And you're trying to rack your brain going through what advantage does this give them? But it could really just be we got to have fresh bodies going out there, yep. people who are able to play right now. So it's certainly a difficult spot. It's something that, you know, when you talk about the men's team who had a layoff, right? Coach mm-hmm. Neubauer ad nauseum with, yep. you know, we're not in game shape right now and trying to figure things out. So certainly a difficult task for St. Louis to play the full four quarters.
Harbison makes both free throws and immediate full court pressure from the Billikens out of the made free throw. Carpel pushes it ahead, finds Haramaya, who skips it to the right wing for McLaughlin, and the Rams now settle down with 20 to shoot. DeWolf on the right wing. Bounces it up top for McLaughlin. Tries to float it inside. It's deflected for DeWolf. Ripped out of her hands at the foul line. 8 to shoot now for Fordham. DeWolf to the left wing with 6 to shoot now. Defended by Kent. Jab step attacks left. Kicks it out Carpel. She'll try a 3. It's short off the front iron. No, they're going to say hit the side of the backboard. Check that. And it will be a shot clock violation on Fordham. And a quick change. Caitlin Downey right back into the game for the Rams, replacing Meg Johnson, who nearly had a turnover on that possession.
Yeah, it was certainly close. Couldn't really tell whether that hit the backboard or the rim. It was right there, and unfortunate for Fordham because Meg Johnson was right there for the putback.
60-49, Fordham on top, under 4.5 to go in this one. It's Warren, right side drive, pulls up on an 8-footer, and she's got it. Check that, it's Kaija Harbison on the pull-up. 4 straight points for her and the Billikens within single digits. 60-51 with 4:10 to play.
And we've detailed Fordham has done such a good job. Now got to continue to try and get the ball out of her hands.
DeWolf attacks left elbow, pull up, jump shot. Oh, it's so pure from the sophomore. 62-51 Fordham, 23 points for Anna DeWolf. Warren driving left side, kicks it out to the far wing for Clark. And it's loaded to the block for Smith-Triori. Gets center of the lane, goes up with the left hand, gets it to fall off the front iron and through. Miriama Smith-Triori gets it back to single digits, 62-53, as we approach 3.5 to go.
Never want to give up points, but encouraging for Fordham, you're able to force it away from Harbison. That's the process. Now just got to follow through.
DeWolf to the foul line, backs up on Kent, and now into the post for Downey. Looks to face up on Harbison. Up top for DeWolf. She'll launch a three. Can't get it to go too strong. And Smith Traore underneath for the rebound. Up ahead, right to left go the Billikens. It's Clark into the corner. Tries to drive inside. Can't get the layup to go, but a foul's called on Carpell as Clark tried to get to the basket. And that'll send Clark to the free throw line. That is the fourth team foul on the Ram. So Billikens in the bonus the rest of the way as Clark gets set from the line. Just 4 points for her on the afternoon. 1 of 6 from the floor. As the first free throw clangs off the front iron and out. So 62-53. Fordham on top. One more free throw coming for the junior Maya Clark. Free throw on its way. Rattles around and falls through. And the lead is 8. Full court pressure again from the Billikens. It's quickly moved up ahead to Haramaya. Stops on the near wing. And the Rams will push on the brakes as they get it to their point guard, Anna DeWolf. Swings it far wing, Carpell. Bounced up top for Flood. Hands off for DeWolf. Looks to curl off a screen, and she's fouled by Smith Traore as Warren was late trailing that screen. And that's the second team foul on the Billikens. Third personal on Smith Traore.
Fordham has done an excellent job in this game a couple of times when St. Louis has gone to that full court pressure of beating it, something we've seen them have a little trouble with in the past, not here.
Haramaya left wing all alone for three. No good. Rebound inside. And Downey crashing it and forces the foul as well. And this one's going to be on Rachel Kent. Caitlin Downey making her presence felt in many ways today. She gets Fordham an extra possession.
And again, it's Caitlin Downey doing an excellent job in all areas that time with the hustle and able to grab the extra possession.
It's floated up top towards Downey, knocked out of bounds off her hands, and it will go back to St. Louis. Head coach Stephanie Gately wants a foul, but nonetheless, Billikens possession going the other way. Right to left comes St. Louis. It's Kent up top to the far corner for Warren. 8-point game, Fordham on top with 2:30 to play. Smith Traore, right block, gets underneath the basket, kicks it out right corner. Clark all alone for three, too strong off the heel, and Haramaya there for the uncontested board. That would have made things really interesting to get it to a two-possession game. Nonetheless, Fordham ball, Haramaya right wing with 20 to shoot. They continue to orchestrate around the perimeter. It's Flood top of the key. Floats it inside for Downey, and a foul's going to be called off the ball. A great look by the freshman, Matilda Flood, who's played some big minutes down the stretch in this one.
Yes, and someone who has added so much depth to Fordham's rotation here because of her ability to shoot, stretch the floor, play defense, and also pass. She had Downey there just to foul.
And an offensive foul is going to be called this time on Flood off the restart. Haramaya trying to skip it over to DeWolf, and a moving screen is going to be called on the freshman with 2:11 to go in the fourth. 62-54, Rams on top of the Billikens. St. Louis ball moving right to left. Harbison at the logo, defended by Carpell. In and out dribble to the left side. Pulls up jump from the elbow. It's no good. And the rebound batted into the hands of Downey. Harbison, a tough afternoon shooting the ball. 5 of 15 now from the floor. As it's Haramaya left wing. Under 2 minutes to play. Up top, Downey. Now to the right wing, DeWolf with 14 to shoot. Spins into the corner. Loses control on the baseline. And it goes off her fingertips out of bounds. Back to St. Louis with 1:39 to go. 62-54. It's Warren pushing it right to left near side. Fakes the handoff. Now curls to the corner. Stops. 18-foot jump shot. It's good. Marissa Warren with the jumper. 62-56. Now Fordham leads. The inbound goes to Downey. Up ahead for Flood. And she'll slow things up on the near wing. Timeout head coach Stephanie Gately with 1:22 to go in the fourth quarter. Rams looking to close out the Billikens on the road and get their fourth A-10 win during this chaotic conference season. And once again, you're listening on WFUV Sports.
After the game, stay tuned for the one-on-one post-game report immediately following the conclusion of this one right here on WFUV Sports YouTube page.
And we are on the WFUV Sports YouTube page. As Nick mentioned, the men's game taking place on WFUVsports.org. That game at halftime, Rams facing a major deficit, down 29, 44-15 at the break. But on the women's side here, we got a good one going down to the wire. Fordham trying to close things out with under a minute and a half to go in regulation. 62-56, Fordham on top. And in this case, Nick, you feel like one bucket could potentially close this thing out.
For sure, and it's about doing what they've done throughout the duration of this second half and continuing to find the open looks, and wherever it is, if it's on the perimeter or on a cut elsewhere, Fordham has done an excellent job trying to find a way to put it away.
It's floated into the backcourt for Carpell. 15 to shoot now for Fordham. 62-56 lead with a minute 10 to go. Now 10 on the shot clock. Carpell continues to dribble. Hands off to Wolf left side. Curls around a screen. DeWolf into the corner. Jeremiah all alone for three. Oh, yeah! Kendall Jeremiah from downtown. That may be the dagger. 9-point lead for Fordham under a minute to play. It's Harbison for St. Louis. Stops at the foul line. Pulls up on a jump shot. No, but a foul is going to be called on Carpell with 49.9 to go. And Harbison will go to the line, but it may be too little too late for the Billikens.
And again, on that last Fordham possession, it's the movement. It's Anna DeWolf cutting through the lane to a wide open Jeremiah after drawing the defense. Fordham just doing an excellent job of finding what's open in the holes in the St. Louis defense. And Jeremiah comes through knocking down the shot.
Harbison makes the first, 65-57. Just under 50 seconds to play in regulation as Harbison's second free throw is pure. 65-58. And a timeout for Lisa Stone and St. Louis. They want to talk things over. And listen, even if this wasn't a close game, you want to think that the Rams and the Billikens especially, you want to figure things how to play late in games. And for St. Louis especially, they haven't played a game in 41 days. These are the type of situations that you want to practice that you really can't when you don't play any games.
For sure. And it was always the balance for Fordham when we were talking about their layoff as well and trying to figure things out about, okay, how aggressive do we want to be, and what's the balance between trying to get everyone involved versus getting all of our players in our normal rotation? Obviously you're going out trying to win the game, but what does it look like? How far am I going to push the players? And this is just another example of one of those situations. And how do we want to approach this about just playing at the end of the game? What does it look like? And again, the balancing act that all the coaches have to undergo right now because of the crazy nature of this season.
So Fordham would take the timeout themselves in addition so they can move the ball. So both teams accredited with the timeout here. As it'll be Carpell inbounding in front of the Fordham sideline. Immediately comes to Downey inside half court. And a foul is going to be called on Rachel Kent. Two free throws coming for Fordham, and it will be Caitlin Downey at the line. 65-58, Fordham on top with 48 seconds to play. As Downey's first free throw is on the way and through. She extends her season high to 22 points. 66-58, 48.3 seconds to play. As Downey five dribbles. An 8-point lead for Fordham, and the free throw on its way. Front iron, backboard, and in. A 9-point lead for Fordham. Timeout, St. Louis. Caitlin Downey with a season high 22 points to go with 12 rebounds and 5 assists, and she has been the X factor in this one. And Nick, I don't think there's going to be many oppositions to player of the game. It's got to be her right now.
No, this I think is going to be a pretty easy decision for us, but certainly stick with us for the one-on-one post-game report. We don't want to give away exactly where we're going
Sure. Just
right now, but yes, she has been outstanding, and we have detailed it throughout this broadcast, and it's just been so impressive because of the nature of how she's played, and it's everywhere. It's not just from behind the three-point line, but it is the passing and creating the other opportunities for everyone else on the floor and the defense and the rebounding. It's been such a complete performance for Caitlin Downey and a major reason why Fordham is 48 seconds away from walking out of St. Louis with a victory.
Fordham in the net rankings right now at 88th in the nation as Harbison inbounds it to the right corner. Warren will launch a three. She's got it. Marissa Warren with the three. St. Louis within six with 45 seconds to play. Inbound to the near side to Downey, and she's fouled immediately by Kent. That's her fourth. Again, Fordham in the bonus the rest of the way. And if the Rams make their free throws, this one is all but over with 43.1 to go. Caitlin Downey at the line, a chance to tie her career high if she can connect on both. She has 22 points right now. 24 is her career high last year at Charlotte on the road. She was dynamite from downtown then. As her first free throw was on the way and good. So there's 23 points for Caitlin Downey. A 7-point lead for Fordham with one more coming. Rams put all four of their other players in the backcourt. As Downey's free throw on its way and good. And that ties a career high for Caitlin Downey. And a timeout for St. Louis. It's going to be a full timeout. Trailing by eight with just over 43 seconds to play. And how about this duo of DeWolf and Downey? A combined 47 points, 9 made threes between the two, an offensive splurge from Fordham's two stars.
I would say that if those two are able to do this consistently, they're going to win a lot of games this season. And that has been just so awesome to see for Fordham today. And you're trying to find a way to come out of the shooting rut that was the second half against UMass. And you come out this afternoon and things don't go particularly well in the first quarter. You only score 5 points. And then this team was really just able to get things going offensively. And it's a major credit to DeWolf and Caitlin Downey to combine for that 47. And when those two are able to do that, they're going to win a ton of games because of the defense that they're able to play. And this has just been the perfect bounce back performance for them coming off a loss against UMass.
And here's a great stat for you too. If you're Fordham, 20 assists on 26 made field goals. Yeah. It hasn't been isolation. They've been scoring in a lot of different ways. And when they've needed a bucket, it's come off a product of really good ball movement. And DeWolf, Jeremiah, and Downey each with 5 assists today. So even with their superstars scoring, they're creating opportunities for their teammates as well. It's Harbison inbounding in front of that St. Louis bench. And a foul is going to be called off the ball before the inbound. And that one's going to be on Matilda Flood to send Maya Clark to the line. And that's exactly what you didn't need if you're Fordham. Give the Billikens an opportunity to put points on the board with the clock stopped. But nonetheless, it's Clark at the line. Spins it in hand, launches the first, rattles out. So Clark now 3 of 5 from the line today. With a chance to cut this deficit to 7. Clark's free throw on its way. All nylon for the junior. 69-62. Katie McLaughlin checks into the game for Matilda Flood. Full court pressure from St. Louis. Brooke Flowers defending the ball. Carpell can run the baseline. She runs to the near side. Bounces it for Jeremiah. Double team comes. Bounces it up ahead for McLaughlin. Floats it ahead for DeWolf. She catches it near side. Will slow things down. And now Warren finally fouls with 35 seconds to play. DeWolf to the line for 2. She has 23 points in this one. Another terrific outing for the sophomore, who's the Atlantic 10's leading scorer. Just under 22.5 points per game. And she will be upping that point average today. 2 free throws coming. First one on its way and good for DeWolf. 24 for her. And an 8-point lead for Fordham. 70-62 with 35 to go. Ball in her hands. 1 dribble on its way. And she cashes in. 71-62. Fordham leading St. Louis. And a substitution for the Billikens. Kylie Best into the game for St. Louis, making her first appearance of the afternoon. To the near side, it comes for Best. Works her way right to left. Trips on the ball on the dribble. And they're going to call a foul on Kendall Jeremiah in the backcourt. And on back-to-back possessions, Fordham is now fouled before the ball has gone inbounds and before the ball has come across half court.
Wow, that is certainly not how you draw it up defensively. And again, letting St. Louis potentially hang around. They have to make their free throws to do that. But certainly, as you mentioned, the ability to practice these late game situations, this is something that Fordham will have the opportunity to learn from. The hope is that it doesn't come back to hurt them.
Left-handed stroke, Best makes the first. Second one on its way from the freshman is off to the right. Rebound, Jeremiah. And a timeout will be called by Fordham. With Jeremiah ball in her hands this last minute. Feels like it's going to take 20 minutes. But, again, that is the way of college basketball down the stretch. Trying to foul to get back into this game. I want to shout out Kerry McMahon as well, the director of operations for St. Louis basketball. Spent a year with Fordham last year, and she was in charge of the scout team last year. So shout out to her. Glad to see her doing well. And the former A-10 Defensive Player of the Year back in the same season where Fordham won the A-10 title. But a little bit of a world's clashing for her. But nonetheless, looks like she's going to be on the losing side of this one. 71-63, Fordham leading. They will likely advance the ball to the front court. And DeWolf and Downey, 49 combined points between them. Really a dynamite performance. And if you include Jeremiah, who has had a good outing herself, 14 points for her. They have combined for 63 of Fordham's 71 points. So I mentioned balance earlier being something that Fordham maybe had today, but listen, it comes from their three stars, and if you're head coach Stephanie Gately, you'll take this type of performance and run any day of the week.
Well, I guess you don't need balance when you get 25, 14, and 24 from your top three scores. Mm-hmm. I would also add that it's pretty remarkable that none of those points came in the first quarter, right? They all three were scoreless after the first 10 minutes of play, so just – really an impressive effort out of those three and trying to hang on here.
Carpell launches it into the backcourt, and Warren is called for the foul on Anna DeWolf. And that'll send the sophomore back to the line. Looking to add for the Rams, and if you really factor that in, the first 5 points came from a two from Carpell and a three from Matilda Flood. So 63 of the last 68 points have come from those three, as DeWolf can't connect on the first free throw. 28.2 to go, an 8-point lead for Fordham as DeWolf's second free throw hits. 72-63 now, and 26 for DeWolf. Warren races right to left in the front court, goes down the lane, right side drive. Layup is no good. Rebound into the hands of Downey, and she gets it for DeWolf. And once the Rams get it across timeline, they can dribble this thing out. Billiken's not looking to foul. Clark playing close defense on DeWolf at half court with 7 seconds to go. Time continues to tick off. 3-2-1, and that will do it. A massive road win for Fordham. They close the road trip off with a 2-1 record and an impressive performance for Fordham. A 72-63 victory over the Billikens at Seifert's Arena. The 1-1 postgame report is coming up next. You're listening to Fordham Rams Basketball on WFUV Sports.
This is the One-on-One Postgame Report presented by support.wfuv.org and WFUV Sports, home to New York's longest-running sports call-in show and the flagship station of Fordham Athletics.
This is the 101 postgame report here on WFUV. Jackson Heil, Nick DeLuca here with you in the Bronx. A final in St. Louis from Seifert's Arena, 72-63. Fordham topping St. Louis. An impressive performance after what was an ugly first quarter, Nick. The last 30 minutes, Fordham goes 25 points in the second quarter, 17 in the third, 25 in the fourth, and they're able to top the Billikens behind an impressive three-point shooting performance. 13 threes made on the game, and the duo of Downey and DeWolf combining for 50 points, and that's the story of this one.
It absolutely is, and whenever you're able to get that type of production from your top two players, you're going to win a lot of basketball games, and that's just in general. Fordham, when they score 70 points, they're going to win most of the time with the way that they play defense. So they did an excellent job, especially overcoming what was a difficult first quarter, and that, to me, shouldn't go unnoticed, and it's something that they have displayed throughout this entire trip to St. Louis, right? It is the perseverance and the ability to deal with the obstacles of just not knowing that you were going to play that game, having to make the trip and everything that went into it, and I'm sure that that will be a much happier ride home for them than perhaps it even was to have to go to St. Louis and figure out everything that went into it. So Anna DeWolf scoring the 26, Downey the 24, and those two are the catalysts in the reason why Fordham goes home with a win.
And Downey was a superstar, 24 points, 13 rebounds, 5 assists, a balanced performance to say the least from her. She ties her career high in points with 24. We mentioned DeWolf being the leading scorer at 26, but to me, Nick, it was the defense in the second half, specifically on St. Louis's guards. Kaija Harbison at 16 points, but again, inefficient, 5 of 15 from the field. Rachel Kent held to just 3 points in that second half. You got to give Fordham's guards, especially on defense, a lot of credit. And I think the unsung hero maybe for me today is Sarah Carpel. The job she did on Kaija Harbison all afternoon long, she made her life very difficult over the 36 minutes that Harbison played. And Carpel didn't start, but once she got put in the game, she played the rest of the way and was a significant impact on that end.
For sure. And it's how you deal with really great players. And that's what Kaija Harbison is in the A-10. You're not going to shut her down. You're not going to hold her scoreless, but making life difficult on the margins, making this thing a little bit harder to deal with, and the shot, don't give her open looks, and make things as difficult as possible. And I think that that's what Carpel and Fordham's defense did in the backcourt really excellently, especially in that second half. And to hold Kent to the 3 points in the second half as well, someone that burned them down the stretch last year and was good in that first half. The halftime adjustments were apparent for Coach Gately and for Fordham, and a much better second half than even the first, that they closed down on a 15-0 run, and that's going to lead to a victory more times than not.
That was the run that really opened this game up for Fordham, because they made some big shots in that second quarter. Anna DeWolf had a big second quarter to get them back in the game. She had 12 points in that frame after a scoreless first quarter, like you mentioned, and it was the three-point shooting, but it was also the defense that really stepped up. They held St. Louis scoreless in those last 4 minutes of the second quarter. And they got a lot of production on defense from a lot of different folks. Carpel being one that I mentioned. Katie McLaughlin shoots 1 of 7 from the field, but again, she made an impact on the perimeter. And I think you mentioned matchup problems. We talk about Kendall Jeremiah being one on offense. Her defense on the perimeter and her ability to defend inside as well, when they went to Smith Traore, when they went to Brooke Flowers, that was a big difference in this one, because St. Louis, they tried to go big in that second half, and Fordham had an answer pretty much every time down the floor. The only time St. Louis really scored was off a few offensive rebound putbacks, but they really contained the paint after Smith Traore got going early.
And it's been so encouraging for Fordham, because they've had those answers no matter what type of lineup that most of the teams seem to want to play against Fordham in this A-10. They have been able to run out a group that will give them an advantage in some way. And they have really done a good job of that. Of course, the key is then to get the offensive production when you run out a certain lineup from the people that you need to get the production from. And then also those people to hold up on the defensive side, mm-hmm. those players to do that. And today they certainly did, and getting the production from Downey, but also the defense as well. And it was such a key, and she was the glue in the way that they wanted to play today. And Fordham, a hard-earned, well-earned victory over St. Louis.
Let's go to our players of the game, because we mentioned that there really wouldn't be much of a contest for this one, especially for Fordham. And there really is no denying that Caitlin Downey was the player of the game today. 24 points, 13 rebounds, 5 assists, the stat line. Like we mentioned, big shots throughout this one. She iced the game late with her free throws. And I mean, the number you look to, 6 of 9 from three, but the 13 rebounds against a duo of Smith Traore and Brooke Flowers, that's an impressive number in itself, and she was doing it on both ends of the floor.
It's the worst-kept secret about the one-on-one post-game report, right, that it was going to be Caitlin Downey who was the player of the game, but an absolutely superb performance for the number of reasons that we have outlined throughout this game. And where do you want to start? Is it on offense? Is it on defense? Is it passing the basketball, rebounding? Caitlin Downey, that was as complete a performance as – not only we've seen from her since she's been at Fordham, but really anyone. I mean, that's as good as it gets, and the production and the scoring is just sort of the added bonus to the degree of scoring the 24 points. But that's as good as Caitlin Downey has played, I think, in her 3 years here, and a credit to her, and is the reason why Fordham wins that game, because without her, they would have been a really difficult spot. And and Caitlin Downey just passes the test with flying colors this afternoon.
Anna DeWolf with a quiet 26 points. You don't really hear that very much, but she was terrific as well. 26, 4 rebounds, 5 assists to go with it. And Kendall Jeremiah also was excellent in all phases today. 14 points, 9 rebounds, 5 assists. But again, our player of the game will go to Caitlin Downey on that occasion. For St. Louis, there's a couple you could go with. I'm going to go with Rachel Kent. I thought she was excellent early in this one. I mentioned she was scoreless her last performance, first time in her collegiate career. She came out shooting the ball really well, 13 points, just 3 of them coming in the second half, but the 9 rebounds were big and 1 assist. But again, that's more of an afterthought at this point after the way Fordham performed today. Before we wrap things up, let's look ahead for both of these teams, and we'll start quickly with St. Louis. They obviously had a lot of games postponed, 10 to be exact, in this process of 41 days where they didn't really see a game. We'll see what happens with their schedule going forward, but they were supposed to play Dayton on Tuesday. We'll see if that happens. That's likely to get postponed. Actually, it's definitely going to get postponed. What am I saying? Because Dayton was the one that tested positive, but they're supposed to host Rhode Island this Friday at 12 and then also play UMass, who sit atop the conference in terms of net ranking after taking down Fordham and VCU in back-to-back performances. So that's what the Billiken schedule looks like. But as for Fordham, as chaotic a road trip as you're going to get, they return home this weekend against St. Bonaventure on Friday, a 2 p.m. start, against Duquesne, a 1 o'clock start. That's always a tough game. We'll see if the Dukes have Libby Bazalack, who's one of the best players in the conference. And then they get to travel to Davidson to try to avenge that opening loss in the A-10 where they gave up 79 points at home, and which really was a blowout inside the Rose Hill Gym. And then they'll wait another 6 days to take on Richmond on the road. So that is the road ahead for Fordham. Nick, any final thoughts before we close this thing out? Fordham with their fourth A-10 win of the year.
Just a complete performance on both ends of the floor, particularly after a rough start. And I think that was the most encouraging thing, because we can detail the players that we felt gave them an advantage today. And it's not to diminish how great Caitlin Downey was or Anna DeWolf or Kendall Jeremiah or anything that led to that, but it's the overarching mentality for Fordham, right? Facing the adversity, overcoming it. It was a difficult loss for them last time out against UMass. They bounced back after a really difficult performance in that first quarter. Things did not start well, but they did not get discouraged and were able to continue to fight and do a great job there. And that just is in keeping with everything that they have faced throughout this season. We've heard Coach Gately say, you know, when you win in an ongoing pandemic, it's two victories, both being able to play the actual game and then actually winning it there. So Fordham, a ton of credit goes to them in navigating everything that went into this road trip. You're on your bus, you're going to Dayton. Oh no, we got to go to St. Louis now. And to come away with a win facing that adversity was really impressive, and a great job, and a great deal of credit goes to Fordham this afternoon.
Well, Nick, a pleasure as always, partner. It was obviously not an ideal scenario given what happened. I don't think anyone was expecting Fordham to play St. Louis this weekend. And Alex Wolves is our producer today, along with you. A huge shout out to both of you guys for getting us and keeping us on the air with this remote broadcast. But once again, the final score of today's game, Fordham 72 and St. Louis 63. The sports director of WFUV is Bobby Chaffardini, and the producer of today's game has been Alex Wolves and Nick DeLuca. Fordham's next game is this Friday when they return home to take on St. Bonaventure. Tip-off for that one is Friday at 2 p.m. with the one-on-one pregame report coming at 1:55 on WFUVsports.org. As for the men, they are in action on Wednesday, January 20th, when they take on Davidson on the road at 1 o'clock. Tip-off is at 1 o'clock, like I mentioned, with the one-on-one pregame report coming at 12:55 on 90.7 FM and WFUVsports.org. Until next time, for my partner Nick DeLuca, I'm Jackson Heil. Have a great evening, everybody. Fordham Rams Basketball is a production of WFUV Sports.